Can you think of any laws that give government the power to make decisions about the male body?
I'm happy to answer a more specific question.
Male versus female.
There are medical procedures.
That the government has the power to make a decision about a man's body.
I thought you were asking about medical procedures that are unique to men.
I'll repeat the question. Can you think of any laws that give the government the power to make decisions about the male body?
I'm not thinking of any right now, Senator.
Hey, one rule, one thing, one rule, man, that shit don't change, sir. Real niggas do real fucking things, real niggas do. Hey, there's only one rule, one thing, one rule, man, that shit don't change, and it's sir. Real niggas do real fucking things, real niggas do real fucking things.
Being lazy, boy.
I went to look for a 3-minute monologue, and I ain't got my book. You know, you got an African American book with all the monologues in it. Nigga ain't got the book no more. So on the internet, they would have it. They had no 3-minute monologues like that I liked.
Heard that boy tone switch. Sound like he lying to us, D. Mm-hmm. He said, "We'll do it." All right,
I'm not gonna fuck. You know what I'm saying?
I can't. I smell a whole lot of BS. Right
now. I mean, fuck. All right, yeah, I got a little lazy. Right? Yeah, yeah.
Could say that from jump.
Yeah, man. But I tried to do a little bit of research. It just didn't work out for me because I'm lazy.
It's a play.
Yeah, it's that Nicole Noir shit again. I had to push that back because I was on NCIS yesterday. I was on that for 2 days, really, and I met Chill. And nigga, me and him talking, chopped it up. He asked me if I knew anybody that worked on a set before and did the show. Name dropped you, and nigga said, "Oh yeah, I know him." You know what I'm saying? I was like, damn, Marty never said he met Chill.
We met in a table read.
But he was like, "That's your boy? Yeah, I know him, man. That's your boy. Yeah, yeah." In my ass, I rolled that way. Yeah, that's my boy. Yep. You got to check out our films. Gumbo Monster Power. We be doing our thing here. You know
I ain't
saying?
Go through Chill on the bus, but we met table read. Cool as hell, though.
He real cool, you know what I'm saying? Because, you know, anytime I see a black actor making it, I give it props. I suck your dick for 30 seconds, you dick. I tell you, hey, thank you for being black in the business, still grinding. I look up to, you know, I like your work, and I look up to, you know, people that still making success as black. That's it.
I'm like that more so to older black actors.
Well, yeah, he up there.
No. I feel you. Chill got longevity, but that's what I'm saying. Like, people would like, because I was like that with CCH Pounder when I was on NCIS.
Yeah, but I ain't going to be like that with Jason Mitchell. I'll be like, yeah, Jason Mitchell, I see you do your thing. Congratulations.
I mean, you already met Jason Mitchell.
But I mean, when I did, or anybody like that kind of stature, I guess that's a nigga like...
Yeah, that's peer.
Yeah.
I'm going to say what's up. Like you just said, I'm going to give you your props. You feel me? But like you just said, that the whole rolling out the red carpet of my mouth slurping on your penis.
Nah,
that's that. You gotta be older, because I respect the hell out of longevity. Because
being
a young nigga like us in the game trying to get it is like the see that you stayed in this for decades.
That's where
all my respect comes. And then you're still working.
That's what made me with Chill. Like, chill, dog. You've been here since fucking house party,
nigga.
Since
you was younger than us,
right?
Because he was younger than us on house party, son. He was younger than us, so okay, I'm right. Like, Chill, been doing it.
And then you came back in the game after your accident and
still acting from a wheelchair, nigga.
You know what I'm saying? Still gigging. That shit, that's why I get a manager's respect on it. Boy, ain't gonna lie. He gave me a little kind of fist, you know what I'm saying? Like, you know, respect. And then we chopped it up and shit about extra work and shit like that, you know? Just fun shit about that. And then I told him about this play I was auditioning in. And he was like, "What play?" I was like, "Nicole Noir." He's like, "I'm gonna come check it out." I was like, "You should." He's like, "Man, I come check out everything." I was like, "Well, shit. I mean, I guess you don't really know when you're on stage and in the audience who coming, but. Alright, I'll be looking for you. I hope."
I ain't saying nothing else about that, but
right,
that's
like, some things like I won't probably see you, son, but I hope you do come.
Yeah.
And when you do see me again, be like, "I did see you." That's what I expect. More than me seeing you, I hope you see me.
I mean, I always say I'm in feeling more and more, dog. It's not about who you know, but who knows you.
That's all it's about, dog. I used to say that way back in the time, dog. It's who you know is what gets you there, and what you know is what keep you there. I used to say that all the time.
That's not what I just said. We just said two different things. What you said was real, but
you said like it was who you know, right?
I said it's not about who you know. It's about who knows you.
You feel me? I see what you're saying.
And that's what. But what you're saying is real too, because you got to be prepared when you get that. Like, you know what I mean?
Well, that's true. It still works on that. My thing still works on your if once a nigga knows you to open up that door. What you know is gonna keep in that
bitch. Nigga, I'm not saying what you're saying wasn't real or couldn't go with what I'm saying. I'm just saying we ain't say the same thing. That's all. Fuck.
Where's the fuego?
That is all. But yeah, man. Welcome to the Fly with Bats podcast. What episode this is, man?
68.
Welcome to the Fly with Bats podcast, episode 68. This is that actor guy, Martin Bats Bradford. You can find me on all your social media platforms at Mr. Bats. Spell it Mr. Out. You ain't going to find me. And as usual, I'm with the squad, the Potty Mouth Pothead podcast. You heard the flicker of the flame. A.K.A. my brothers.
What up? What's good? It's your boy, D-Mac. And you can catch my Instagram at friendshipred.kid. And make sure you follow my clothing line at yourdig504. And yeah, I thought this was episode 59, but I guess we're on 60. So
we're on 60. The last one was 59. He right, because I remember putting it up.
I only been off a few times, but I usually am on the ball with these numbers. Usually I'm on the ball.
59. B was the last one, so we're on 60. 68 for this set.
Posse Wise, your boy AlphaJo, fresh out of the gumbo, still deep in the roux. And if you're out in the streets and you're looking for me, you can find me on Instagram at AlphaJo504.
See, nigga, they switched it up on yourself. Don't even know what's going on.
It's still kind of new. So AlphaJo504 on Instagram, Joseph Alphaman Pines on Facebook. And for sideA, we in this bitch, man.
We in this thing. And what's funny is since we do two sides, though, we really like on episode like 100. Something or very close, because like because we weren't always doing two sides, so I think there's like a good first maybe 15 episodes of just regular this episode that, maybe like 16 or 20 somewhere around that we started doing two sides. Either way it go, we're saying 68,
110.
But you know, yeah, we got a lot. we recorded a lot, and all we've had, there's 129 podcasts over the past 2 years, so you know.
110 sound about right to say we did 110, maybe.
Maybe, because, the reviewing that is on 40, and if I take out at least a good three or four of those reviewing that is us reviewing shit, I just added all the reviewing things in the same reviewing thing. So it's like three or four of us reviewing, or the reviewing that, which is at 41, that makes viewing that at least at, like, what, 38, you dig? So take 38 from 129, and if we ain't at 100, we close as fuck at to 100.
I did the math of like let's say we did 60 episodes, we did 60 episodes, I doubled that and then subtracted 10 episodes from that. That's how I wound up getting 110. And now with the other episodes, it seemed like
saying if we had 129 episodes of fully, I already take one off because me and Raheem at that one wrestling podcast that makes 128 episodes. If there's like 37, 38 episodes of reviewing that podcast,
right?
You feel me? That's its own show.
It takes us out of the game already, dog. Like,
it takes us under 100, but close to it is what I'm saying. I'm saying true. We're close to 100 of just Fly with Bats, which is pretty fucking cool.
How close is the question? So we can know what 100 day we get the 100.
We'll do the math at some point. Welcome, y'all. What's popping, y'all? First and foremost, I want to say thank y'all to all the new listeners, man. We had a pop up in listeners. We got more people peeping us out.
Sweet.
We also got more views on the doc and more good reviews on the doc. Thank you. It was like three different people hit me in my messenger and was like how much it was feeling, the movie we did at the 48, or they peeped the doc and it was digging and shit. And I was like, thank y'all. Cool. Thank y'all.
Thank you.
So keep checking that out, the doc and all our other movies on Gobble Monster 504 on YouTube. And man, appreciate all the new listeners, man. Hit us up at flywithbats@gmail.com because we want y'all to be part of the conversation. You hear me? So first off, before we get into it, that's just the sound of me hitting the bleezy. Let's get into our scroll of local podcasts. Mm-hmm. And y'all should also be peeping out for Instance. The Your 30 Podcast with Marty Edwards and the Arrogant Observer. A Misbelief Radio Show podcast with the homie Who Is DC Paul, Oshun, Malik the Historical Geek,
and us.
Besides, I'm about to say, who else? Oh, Jay Steele, Fat Girl Nola, Steele, and us. Also, the Brooklyn Ladies of Therapy Noir podcast, the We'll Figure This Out podcast, the Metal Hand of God podcast, Black Guys Next Door podcast, Fuck What You Heard podcast, Books to Bills podcast, Hip Hop Nerd podcast, the, what's that one with your boys?
Which one?
I always forget it. No DC Brother. Sundays. No Dope on Sundays.
Yep.
No Dope on Sundays podcast. On the Lake podcast, who will be on here with us tomorrow. We'll record with them at noon. Yeah.
All right.
Crossover tomorrow with the On the Lake podcast and the four Mrs. and the Mike podcast. My other little, Guilty Pleasure podcast.
I got another podcast I want to give to you too.
Is it local?
Yeah, it's local.
Who that is?
It's my homegirls of mine. And they from here, but they just graduated from Southeastern. But they got a podcast called The Teapot.
The Teapot. Have you listened to it?
I listened to one episode.
What they were talking about?
it's kind of like, it's almost like if you take On the Lake and make that bitch ratchet. You know what I'm saying? Like, in the ratchet form. You know what I'm saying? That's what it kind of is. It's like same topics. The first topic is about relationships in college, but it's really... it's hard for me to listen to it because they these girls.
Well, I said, did you listen to it? But then you didn't tell me nothing.
I was like 10 minutes and I was like, I'm going to come back to this. You know what I'm saying? Because it's just so, it's so ratchet. Because they're my homegirls and I love them to death. But they got a nice podcast.
Is it good though? Because I'm saying, because right now, you're not giving them a regular
Right now, they're good as people. So I'm going to say that their pod is good. I can't really tell you. I'm not gonna lie to you. I'm just gonna give a shout out now.
Don't got me shout out poo ass podcast.
Hold on. We were shouting out On the Lake before we heard any episode.
Yeah, no, but I also did say on there I have to listen to it. And I went and listened to it before I continued to shout them out. I was like,
this is our first one. I'm just giving a shout out as a startup. This is a startup shout out. The next one we come, all right, put it like this. I'll give it to you this.
And Rel, our friend. Yeah, that's right. Your friend. We don't know who you're talking Rel. About. You hear me? Well, What? What's up, Chelsea? What's up, Frankie Cola?
Hey, y'all.
So, tomorrow, I'll have info about the teapot in direct. So y'all get y'all starter, starter shout out with
I
me
like
now.
That. I like
and
that.
Tomorrow, you get the full info.
I like
it. You peeped him?
I like that. That's more like it.
Watch what you say to me. Man, who else we supposed to be shouting out these local podcast streets?
I think that's it. We ran through them.
We did everybody. We did Metal Hand of God.
There's another one that I
Black
just added. Where are they? There's one more, and I was like, oh, this is another New Orleans podcast. Where is it? I'm about to promise to shout you guys out next time. Where is it? I just added some people because I was so surprised it was from New Orleans and it was actually pretty enjoyable. I listened to one episode and I'm mad I don't know their name. Well, y'all people, I'm going to let y'all know next time. But in the meantime, also shout out to the 50420 podcast. Yes.
I have been dying for like 8 days just wondering what this email says.
So, yeah, man. So, if you listen to the last, my last episode of FLYWITHBATS podcast, during this part where we always shout out the local podcast, I had a very similar moment of finding another local podcast and I shouted them out, the 50420 podcast. I thought it was a cool name. It's some of the cats that, to be talking about weed and shit. And,
so some of us is on that episode talking cash money.
We get high. So, of course, if it's a weed podcast, that was interesting to me. And he was here and shit. So, I was like, all right, boom, boom, boom. But then, one of us.
Some of us.
This was like, man, fuck them off the dump.
Yeah, one of us.
And if they some gentrifying motherfuckers, they need to not take this name from my peoples that sell edibles who got the same name, 50420 Edibles. You dig? And, my only point towards it was, their podcast might have been around longer. That's all I know.
We came out to be proven. That was fact.
Yeah, their podcast was around longer, so we can't hate on the cats, et cetera, et cetera. Then we wondered, are they black? Because that's the thing. I assumed that they were white. Just listening to them talk, they just felt like white guys to me. But then we got to remember, son, they got people from all over. Like, they could.
Black boys come in a myriad of things.
I mean, people.
I've been told that I sound white.
See, people before, come so. In a myriad of casings and for this shit. So, you never know. So, I didn't know that. I was surprised when they emailed us back. And I told the homies that I was like, no, 50420 podcast hit us back. So, that's why they said they've been waiting. Because it's like, I was like, okay, we're going to read it on the podcast. Because I didn't even read this whole email yet. I read the beginning. And that was about it. So, I was like, we live on the podcast.
You didn't sneak and read a little bit of it, huh?
I haven't read anything aside from what I read to y'all, which was what was the first paragraph.
We are better men than me, Charlie Brown.
Yeah, son.
I read the fuck out that shit.
Nah, son, because I was like, this is podcast content. Why read it now? Is that guy always like?
Tea.
It might not be tea. It might be them just being like, hey, y'all right. We some crazy crackers over here. We sorry for taking a name. I don't know what the fuck they talking about, son, but, you know, I appreciate them hitting us up, dog. And like I always say, anybody want to hit us up, talk to us, have something to say, hit us up at flywithbats@gmail.com, even if you're another podcast, especially if you're another podcast.
Especially.
You hear me? We can run it. You hear me? So, without further ado, let's see what they talking about.
What did they say?
Hello! ! I'm one of the co-hosts of the 50420 podcast, going by the moniker Magic Sam.
Magic Sam.
Thank you for mentioning us on this episode of Fly With Bats. After hearing your discussion, I thought I would reach out to say hello and make an introduction. Here's another thing I was saying. I keep saying it, bro. You never know who's listening.
Right.
You just really never know. Because I didn't even know these cats was even listening to us. I was shouting them out on the strength of, well, y'all a local podcast. We're a local podcast. Mm-hmm. If I come across local podcasts, if I'm the only motherfucker doing it, I'm going to shout y'all out. You hear me? Yeah.
Son, they listen to us. I feel like maybe the couple of hours we didn't put it up the same day.
I don't know if I ain't gonna put same day on
the response was the next day.
We got the response within a day or two. I'll give them that wiggle room within a day or two. Mm-hmm. Meaning they had to listen to it, you know, soon, so they might be people that already listen to us, which is pretty damn cool. Appreciate that. So they said, you guessed correctly that we are a couple of white dudes. We've started this podcast really as a way of having some fun, getting stoned, and talking about our shared pastime of cannabis consumption. We do discuss various strains we are using at a given time, and also like to talk about the various methods and gear we happen to be using during a given episode, be it bongs, glass pipes, vaporizers, both oil and herb, edibles. There are attempts to get into political topics that relate to cannabis, but honestly, we usually end up getting too stoned and ramble away off topic, which I noticed. I did listen to a couple of y'all joints.
I can understand that totally.
You're stoned.
Hell yeah, we can understand that, guys. Trust us. Yeah. Overall, to date, our shows are kept on a lighter tone and have been a means for us to get more experience with being comfortable on the mic and getting used to the creative cycle of recording, editing, publishing a show. We keep our identities anonymous as we both have day jobs and still have policies that are behind the times insofar as cannabis use, regardless of medical or recreational designations. Okay. Our anonymity policy is also there for certain guests we are lining up for future episodes as we have interviews with local growers, independent dispensary operators, and medical professionals and patients who have some concerns with discussing certain topics on such a public forum coming up in the weeks ahead. Yeah, I feel you, dog. See, we artists and shit, so we could kind of say our names.
Yeah.
But if I worked in that field, like, of, you know what I mean? Like,
whatever you do,
whether it's some cubicle, whatever it is, that I totally.
You must be some kind of lawyer somewhere.
I probably wouldn't even be going by Mr. Bats if I had one of those type of jobs. I'd be like, yeah, what's up, y'all? It's Batty Bravo. That's some shit, so I totally get it. Neither of us can or do claim to be New Orleans natives. But as my co-host Zekio and I live in New Orleans, we end up talking about New Orleans experiences or stories most relating to cannabis use and consider the show based out of New Orleans. Anything, Joe?
Anything? Right now, no.
Nothing?
Right now. They admit it. They're not from here.
I remember. I'm saying you were very passionate.
Very passionate.
About them being not from here. Maybe.
I mean, they admitted it.
You thought they was going to hide it.
No, I thought I didn't know what they was going to do. Taking your lick is the best thing you can do. Yeah, all right, so you're not from here. I wonder where you are from. I want to know that.
Here's more for you, though. Here's more for you, Joe. On the name 50420, we had no idea your friends were starting a business brand with that name. We were really just stoned and thought it sounded like a cool title.
It sounded real cool, didn't it?
When we were going for insofar as a podcast.
Gentrification always sound cool.
See, there, now you get froggy over there. See how you feeling? The only other use of the name I could find appears to be an independent dispensary operator working out of the metro Washington, D.C. area with an Instagram account, 50420. Why the fuck are you in Washington with 50420?
It's regulation out there.
No, I'm saying why 50420?
I gotta figure that out.
You hear me? That's what I'm saying. Yeah, do your thing. Smoke your shit, dog. But you know that, you know, it sounds like some noise. Especially, I guess we got the New Orleans vibes.
I guess the 50 must be different because our 504 connects. Maybe the 504 don't connect.
Cool name. Is this who you meant on your show? No, we do not know that. No.
We're talking about locals, baby.
We talking about these girls we know that that sell edibles. And, you know, maybe they didn't get their name licensed and fishy. Who knows?
Not yet, you know. You know how New Orleans work.
I mean, y'all are podcast, they edibles. Hopefully y'all shit don't cross. Subsequent searches online on social media outlets, both the U.S. copyright trademark registries don't bring up results. So I'm not entirely sure who we should reach out to regarding the name. And to date, we have received no communications or cease and desist from anyone regarding our use of it. Do you know to whom we should get in touch with on that?
Meaning we did our fucking paperwork.
Yeah, listen here, dog.
Meaning, yes, we're white. We're white, and we're going to do our motherfucking research.
We're going to do check everything our by the book.
You're not going to sully our goddamn podcast name, Alpha Joe, and try to act like we stole this shit.
We did our due diligence.
The entire diligence of the due.
And we researched this fucking name.
Motherfucker.
And it's all not right. Copyrighted.
What you saying, Joe?
Number one.
Talking all that shit
laws
to us.
Always work for white folk. That's number one.
Oh my God. Go ahead, talk your shit.
Number two. Yes, I'm glad you did your research. But apparently you didn't do enough.
Oh, hey,
because
hey,
the
hey.
Name still exists. And if I know it, and other people know it, it's out
no,
there.
No, no, no.
So you look.
You know it. Who are these other people?
DC.
That's not gonna
no, no, no.
That yeah, wouldn't, that that's DC's hold up court. Event.
I ain't never heard of the 5420 podcast until it came up. I knew about the trees. All right,
no, now you're flipping and deflecting. We're
they
saying
say the same thing about right? We never heard of 504 edibles. Like,
they lied. I'll say this though.
They say we didn't Google. We didn't look up the freaking credentials, the copyright.
We went to the copyright.
Sound like the homies just decided one day, you know what? We're going to name our shit 504 Edibles. Right. 5420 Edibles. And they just went from there.
It was because it was called Little Denny's. But I'll say this.
Well,
since both of y'all are 5420, I think you should reach out to them. And y'all should have a cross podcast where she brings her edibles in for y'all to try. And y'all can talk about her edibles on podcast. So,
oh, that's how you're going to tie it in?
Yep. That's how I'm going to put a bow on this shit.
That's how you put a bow on
so
it.
So how are you going to put them in contact with these people?
DM me at Instagram, AlphaJo504, J-O, no E, and I got you.
Because I feel like at this point, the white niggas get to keep their name, do y'all thing, keep doing y'all thing.
It sounds
point,
like
yeah,
they
yeah.
get to keep their name.
You feel me? Not saying your name was ever on the burner, but just because Joe was talking all that shit.
And you ain't from here.
Yeah, you hear me? And you ain't from here, but awesome shit. Yeah, you
I
right.
I the cleverness of it.
It was clever. Y'all was how y'all came up with it. They came up with it by their own merit. It's not like they saw the 5420 Edibles girls
was
and said,
like, yeah, that's hot.
We're gentrifying that shit. No, it was like, they started first. I don't want y'all thinking that we literally seriously were coming for y'all.
No.
It was all jokes, y'all. Right. It was all jokes.
The fact that y'all went and like went to the Treasury and then went to the DC state of law to figure out if anybody else was 50420. Son, I was not hard up about that.
But we appreciate
but
y'all.
We appreciate y'all.
Specifically because they're not from here, so they was like, you know what, we don't want to disrespect the land.
Respect the ancestral grounds. You know what I'm saying? Respect the native land. And I thank you.
And they said, all apologies for such a long-winded email. I really do appreciate your mentioning us on your show and for that moment being one of the dozen or so listeners we've had. We will gladly tell all 12 or so folks who listen to us about your show on our next recording. You have an amazing podcast that I'm just beginning to dig into and catch up on. But the range of topics and depth the FLYWITHBATS crew gets into on them makes for thought-provoking and entertaining hours of listening. Hope to talk soon. MS, the 50420 podcast.
Say something, man. Something.
Thanks. Slow something. This nigga talking all that shit. Now it's
now
mad something.
Now his best fucking friends now.
Let's match balls.
Look,
dog.
Fam, listen. We had your back from Jump Street.
From day one.
This motherfucker. This motherfucker. Y'all gonna go check his white name over
your brother? This motherfucker's trying to play catch up. You know what I'm saying? We knew y'all wasn't tripping. We just got a motherfucking maniac in our midst.
Listen, Sam. Let's match bones. All right? We're gonna have a match party, all right?
You the Gordy podcast. All
right? I should. I really should.
That should you be your penance. You need to go make a guest appearance on the 50420 podcast.
If they'll have you. Talking
if they'll
all
have
that
you.
Shit.
If they let you come in the house. That Mother. Might be a little
oh,
bit
oh, oh, oh,
that
gotta,
might be a little
I
bit
I gotta get the podcast out back.
You gotta come in the back door.
Motherfucker.
That's funny.
All right. Yeah.
But so, they seem like a couple of stand-up guys, though. Shit.
Yeah, I'm listening to a few.
Smoke some good running, you know what I'm saying? I'm looking at any podcast.
They know they weed shit. Because, see, me, like, I've tried damn near everything. All us together have basically tried damn near every way
mostly
to smoke,
everything.
Every way to do. I don't need to get into the resume, but I just know I'm at a point in my life where I only smoke what I like. and I just like blunts. I don't like bongs.
Yeah.
I don't like pipes. I like, because at one point, you know what I mean, you make yourself do these other things because you got all these, you know.
Experiment.
You try to see what's up. And but at a point, you know what I mean, I got to be honest with myself. Like, you know, like I said, I don't like drinking. You feel me? At a point, I still, every night, if I feel like taking, getting one drink, I drink one drink, but I'm not a drinker. At a point, I don't know.
That's how I am now.
If I had to choose bongs, I'm going to go with the blunt. If I had to choose between a pipe, I'm going to go with the blunt. If I had to choose between joints, I'm going to go with the blunt. You feel me? So please, please, please always know I'm a nigga smoker from a go.
For sure. Likewise. I'll do a bong every once in a while.
If you offer, I'll hit your shit to be polite, but just know I would have rather.
But preference, I'm going to always prefer to smoke blunts for sure.
I'm a
here you go bong with everything.
Hitter, here you wax go. Getter, real nigga, blunt splitter, joint roller, all that shit in the vaporizer, let me smoke up. I do it all. You know what I'm saying? Whatever you got in the house that's going to get us high, let's do it.
Brand new socks and drawers.
But I will also agree with my brothers. The blunt is ritualistic.
Yes, it's definitely a ritual. I can agree with that.
So it has to come around some part of the ceremony somewhere. Like, we could smoke we could do 100 bong rips. I'm still going to roll up that blunt.
You know what I do like, though? Honestly, just as much as blunts, I just don't have one. Vaporizers.
I love vapes.
I love a vaporizer, though. That I can put weed in. Like, not weed oil, but like
actual trees.
Yeah, like, I do like those. Them bitches be hitting. You know what I'm saying? But I ain't got the cachet to get one of those, so.
On top of that, I'm a wax hitter these days. Like I don't get as much because I ain't got the utensils for it. But hanging out with my homeboy in BR, I ain't going to put you out there right now, but you know who you are.
That's the homie.
The waxer of all waxers.
No, wax that ass is what he said. You ready to get that ass waxed?
Oh, yeah. And that ass will get waxed. Sent that nigga bass floating one time back to work.
Mm-hmm.
But
I can't say where I was going to work.
No, back to work. And he literally did fly. I saw him. But no, like and only the way they follow forward, I feel like the way they talk about it is the way I look at it these days too. Cause like I'm in New Orleans, you can't really get the strains you want like you would get in other places where it's recreational.
No, you
so
can't.
You kind of get what you can get and hope you can get high.
I'm like, what happened? Cause at one point, maybe because just being in college, because I remember when we was in college, I felt like that's when I had all the strength. But maybe because there's so many people from other places.
Say that's from
bringing their connects and shit.
Because
I'm like,
that's definitely what it was. Like, the college campus is still like the best dispensary you can go to.
Well, because I feel like I'm smoking the same thing everybody's smoking in New Orleans. I feel like they be having like 3 strains at once at any given time in New Orleans. And
now, I'll tell you this.
This is whatever, dog. 50420 niggas, if y'all got some shit, let us know. Who y'all connect? That's DM and an email away.
They said they do.
I mean, let's run it.
In the email, they say they be talking to all the local, everybody.
Yeah, you
talk
to the local locals, like, huh?
New one in my life. But yeah, so that was our little detour. Let's get to the show. So for side A of the Fly With Bats podcast, we usually get into the starter section. That's little hot topics, things that's popping off and whatnot in the area, in the game and such. Mm-hmm. After the starter section, we get into Bats Nerd Out moment. Where the homies allow me to nerd out on certain things, entertainment, comics, movies, TV, what have you. After Bats Nerd Out moment, Joe, you got some shit in the sports corner?
Yeah.
You got any sports ass shit to talk about that me and D ain't gonna care about?
Well, I got some sports shit that relates into a little bit of politics.
Okay, we'll see what that is in Joe's Sports Corner. And we'll see if we have time for a question today. Then we take the turn over to that other side, that side B, where we get into that etouffee of the day. And we get into more of the heavier topics that's been going on throughout the week or whatnot. After the etouffee of the day, we get into that Daily Dose of America.
And that's that friendly reminder of just where you live and just who the fuck you dealing with.
Ouch.
Streets.
Then we have that hero highlight where we take the time to shine light on someone who's doing good in the world of pure D fuckery.
And then we tell you to come fuck with us on the next couple of couplets, you feel me? So without further ado, let's get to that starter section.
Do it. DJ.
Lying about how much you had made. Rumors and shit that you handmade. Would you buy this if I sold that? Hey, what the hell is my soul at? The American need for American green is America's greed. That's the American dream. Black America too busy chasing white American dreams. But we sleep, so let's everybody eat then repeat.
Work, I.
Where the fuck the cheese? Where the mozzarella at? Tell me where it be.
All right, there's so much tea going on. I don't even know where to start in the starter section, man. Feel me? But I'm gonna stay. I'm gonna start. I'm gonna first off and say, rest in peace to both Burt Reynolds and Mac Miller.
Yeah, I used to like Burt Reynolds a lot. I loved him in what was that movie where he played the cop and he had the little black child that he was like babysitting or something.
I know what you're talking about.
That shit came out way
it's
back.
It's on Netflix right now too.
I loved it.
It's a stupid ass title.
Cue the Arrogant Observer of the Euro 30 podcast yelling and screaming.
Yeah.
Yeah,
you
he
don't know this?
He's sad.
It's motherfucking blah 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 blah. The man with the most respectable mustache, porn stash of the 80s.
Not a kindergarten cop, huh?
No, that's Arnold Schwarzenegger.
That's Arnold.
So that's one of my favorite movies.
So which one was the one with Burt Reynolds?
I'm about to tell you right now.
I'm on his IMDb. Let's look. What year you think that was?
This was like the 90s.
You see the picture of it. It's just him and his black kid with the police hat on.
All right, so if we get to the 90s, we're looking at Mystery Alaska, Stringer, Puck.
Nah, this is like early 90s. Early 90s. I was small.
So let's get to Modern Love, BL Striker, Out of This World, The Player,
Cop and a Half.
Cop and a Half, baby.
Cop and a Half. I used to like that joint, man.
Oh, okay, here we go. I've never seen it.
It was cool.
Now, Burt Reynolds.
I mean, it's a 90s movie, you know, so.
Mac Miller, rest in peace to both of them. But I do want to go on record saying that I don't know any of Mac Miller's music. I never listened to Mac Miller. And I really don't know anything about Mac Miller at all.
I don't know much about the dude neither, but I'm still sad that he.
Yeah, it's a sad life loss at a young age too, as well.
Yeah.
But I'm just saying, as far as references, like I want to, you know, give my respects to the dead. But I just want to say also, Burt Reynolds is probably the one that hit me a little bit harder. That's why I'm saying it, because I didn't grow up with Burt Reynolds, but I grew up with Burt Reynolds because I grew up with old folks, so therefore I grew up with Burt Reynolds. And Burt Reynolds has been in a lot of things besides the like just those movies. He's been in great TV shows and shorts and great comedic skits and different comedy sketches. And he was also in The Longest Yard, both times. So
I like Burt, man. He was a talented actor for sure. You know, like I didn't ever see him really sucking. You know, so
well, Burt Reynolds. Here's a fun fact about Burt Reynolds. Him and Clint Eastwood were fired on the same day off of two different sets. Burt Reynolds was on Gunsmoke, starring Matt Dillon, and Clint Eastwood was on Rawhide, and both of them niggas got fired at the same day. And Burt told Clint in the parking lot, I don't know what you about to do, but I'm about to go take me some acting lessons. Because that's the reason Burt got fired. They said he couldn't act.
Mm-hmm.
Well, so, yep, the more you know, right?
And look, that man had a whole career, became a whole fucking legend in the game.
Right.
Here, that's what I'm saying, bro. You stick to your shit. That was
he was on Beverly Hills 90210.
Man, this man was on a lot of shit, though.
That's cool.
Most men, they got a stash like that, go on to do great things.
The porn stash.
Like, it's like the porn stash / sleazy business stash / Western shoot your stash.
He's like the most notorious person to pull it off.
Though. Him and Charles Bronson.
And Rick Rude, wrestler Rick Rude, rest in peace.
Yep.
Rick Rude looked just like them niggas.
Now it's Rick's dad.
But like, yeah, man, rest in peace to Burt Reynolds. I say the same thing you guys say. Rest in peace to Mac Miller, like you said as well. I know a few of his little joints. I like what I heard, but I'm not going to sit up and pretend like I was a fan of him. Like, I see a lot of my Facebook friends,
yeah,
Instagram
very
friends.
Sad.
And I was like, so, like, y'all saying, losing a life sucks, 26, that's major.
Yeah.
And a lot of people was like, it was so trippy. One thing I do remember about him is when his last album dropped, people were talking shit. You feel me? Some people were talking shit about how, like, he was tripping for putting out on Astroworld. I mean, the same day as Astroworld. Some people saying that, man, he sound real depressed on this album. Yo, watch it, boy.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that's a trippy thing. In the 90s, niggas were getting gunned down. But now, niggas is over the ODing and shit. Like, well, Triple X got gunned down. Damn, shit don't change, I guess. But it's just an interesting thing. Like, you see it in, you hear it in the music of all these people on more drugs and depression and
you
drugs and depression.
I keep saying it, dog. Niggas dancing away other people's depression.
Yeah, son, and it's just trippy that and all this happened right in your face, because you know a lot of news reports have called him Ariana Grande's ex-boyfriend dies, and I'm like, bro, don't do
that. That's shitty.
No, don't do that. Someone on the internet even shaming Ariana Grande for his death.
No, son. I was about to get to that point. No, she had to turn off her Instagram because people are blaming her. Because they just broke up and then she got engaged to this other dude like not too soon after.
Oh.
So they saying that, but the thing is,
but it's still not her fault though.
It's not her fault. On top of that, the reason that she was very clear that the reason they broke up is because he had these substance abuse problems and she kept trying to work with him and fight for him and fight with him and fight with him. He would not let the drugs go. So she was like, you know how
I gotta let you go.
She got to a breaking point, right? She got to a breaking point. That's why they broke up. So it's like, my nigga, of course you know she feels tore up. That's her ex boyfriend. So that's fucked up for you even come at her neck.
But that's stupid, crazy ass fans.
But y'all people coming at her as if
internet, dog.
You know what I mean? Like
them stands, bro. Them fucking stupid ass stands.
Yeah, that's just stupid people.
And just crazy fucked up people. People be fucked up.
People all fucked up, dog. They all fucked up.
Leave that girl alone. That girl just can't get a break. And dog, ever since our last podcast, I've been still thinking about that whole situation, because damn it, everybody, like, so too many people I with the Reverend and her. Too many people I respect, like, really is like, he was groping or burning him. And I'm like, man, son, am I tripping? I just keep on wondering, am I fucking tripping?
You know what's funny?
No, I don't even buy into it, because I kind of feel like you on that shit. Like, a lot of people who I really respect are saying that it was, you know, sexual. But I'm like, no, like, I still don't feel like that. Like, no matter who says the opposite.
A woman, you know what I mean? Was he
groping the titties?
A woman by the name of Geneva Joy told me and Devin out at this Wednesday at the Jazz Market how she felt about it. And that's the first time I really heard somebody say something truthful that I could agree with. And it was also a woman, so I was, like, thankful for as well. Because she basically said, like, that was number one, that was a church hug. This, she said, well, she wasn't coming to defense, but she was, like, letting know of things of what it is. And on top of that, saying that before, if the pastor never even got too close to her, we still would have been dragging her about that damn dress. She was getting dragged all the way until the pastor in that moment happened. But until that happened, and you did these close-ups and made all this dramatic music with the dun-dun-dun on it, it was all dragging Ariana Grande.
And honestly, I think she wouldn't even be catching all this smoke from Mac Miller if the whole church thing hadn't happened first.
No, she was going to catch that smoke because she broke up with him.
Really, you think
and
so?
Then she got with that nigga. Then she got with that nigga fast. She got with her new nigga like it was so fast that was like, she's been riding heat this year. Mm-hmm. She got buku heat for breaking up with Mac Miller, then showing up with her new, like, she got new nigga like
a contest like blew up last year.
I don't know, but I'm just saying, like, it was like she gets heat a lot. Come to think of it, she got a lot of shit. I mean, once she fucked up licking something and putting it back, some food. But anyway, she was going to get heat on that, on Mac Miller, regardless of the dress and the church situation. As far as you said about Geneva, I mean, like, but they got women that, she just basically agreed with you. So I can't say that I'm going to take her.
I can't say she agreed with me, because that's her own opinion.
She said what you know what I'm saying? That's her own opinion, but you agree with that opinion. So, of course, what you already agree with is going to resonate with you, though. I can't leave that out. I can't leave that out of it, because there's other women you could find online also said it was a church hug as well. And just because that's what you believe don't mean that, you know what I mean? Just because I agree with it don't mean I'm going to say that it has more merit than anything else. Because, like I said, they got women that I usually agree with and men that I usually agree with that are riding hard. And like, then they saying that he was fondling the titty and that's what was extra. And they got me being like, okay, did he fondle it in that fast exchange or not? Like, it's just been on my mind on the slick. Just the fact of our conversation on the last episode about it is all.
I mean, that hand thing, it seems like it's on one note, and it has a whole lot of context missing out of it. There's a whole picture right behind that hand that's missing all out of it. Like, when you closed up on Ariana Grande's arm,
And it made me wonder, are we victim blaming? Did she just go along with the flow because, you know what I mean, she in front of all these people?
That's speculation.
I don't know, son, but as far as back-to-back Miller and, you know, her and shit, in all of this, dress, no dress, fondle, no fondle, whatever, leave this lady alone. Like, yeah. She was with that nigga for like 2 years. That was her boyfriend for 2 years, dog, so there's love that's there, and she only broke up with him, not because she didn't love him, because he wouldn't kick his habit. So it's like, my nigga, this lick.
She was with Mac Miller for 2 years.
Like 2 years or so.
But then she broke up and basically instantly got engaged to this other dude.
That's the heat.
That's not, that other dude isn't fucking new.
I mean, that's speculation. 2 years?
That's speculation. You just said speculation.
Because people can fall in love on first sight and then dump off and run.
Quote-unquote fall in love. But I will
grant that caveat.
They rich white people with money.
And who just says they're not friends and they got to know each other to where the moment where now when things were single, they were able to move on to the next level?
That's also speculation if we're going to start calling it that.
But you started with speculation when we said, yeah.
I'm just saying, dog, like, in my personal experience, when people get engaged that quick, they don't get engaged that quick with like new people.
They do. The rich people do.
I don't know. Rich people, when they get on that rich level, they do some shit. Like, yeah. we see people get married all the time. Back yeah. before. Janet Jackson went through three niggas.
I don't see people get married like that.
So you see Janet Jackson get engaged from Jermaine Dupri to another nigga to another nigga. J Lo went from another nigga.
Keep up with any of those marriages.
But I'm trying to tell you, someone who keeps up with a lot of these celebrity cats is not that surprising to see. Fast engagements and fast divorces, because that's what happens.
It still looks just weird to me.
But even with that being said, that still doesn't cause that nigga to go kill himself.
No,
well, I didn't even mention that. But all right,
I'm just saying, because like I'm just saying.
And pause. No. Maybe, who knows if it made him kill himself.
I mean, made him don't a Ariana's
blame
fault.
Her. Right. It's all nigga keep on saying. Just life she's is not, her not fault. To blame. Right. She's just not to blame. Whatever his reasoning was in his mind at the time, she's not to blame for them.
Say, son, if she gonna
Moving on, y'all. Let's move on.
Let's yeah.
move on. Because
rest in peace, Mac Miller.
Rest in peace, Mac Miller and motherfucking Burt Reynolds. So before we get to the white people, let's get what I own, dog. Cardi B and Nicki, man. That's been like.
You gonna start that with that now? We're gonna
bring
the tea now?
Would you rather talk about Eminem and MGK first? I think
let's get them out the way first.
No, son. Let's start with the ladies first. Black women first. Let's go, Cardi B, Nicki Minaj, son. That's your girl, anyway.
Yeah,
that's,
because I got so much to say about
it. No. I'm ironically talking about Nicki Minaj being your girl because you don't like her. But it's ironic. Now I realize, wait, hold up. You are a huge Cardi B fan on top of a huge Nicki Minaj hater. So it's like, we already know
what And I'm biased. I'm going to call her right now. By Cecily.
You heard about this shit, D?
Yeah.
So everybody all the same phase, dog. Apparently, like, you know, I mean, at this, was this some fashion situation? What's this
called? There was a fashion gala at the Balazar in New York.
There we go. So, so apparently, like, they had altercation. It wasn't a fight. I'm mad at these headlines
right,
calling it
a fight.
At
all. It wasn't even close to
you
a
hear
fight.
Me? Cardi B felt some kind of way through her shoe at Nicki, Miss Nicki, and then tried to apparently lunge toward the security. Buku people pulled them apart. One of the security elbowed Cardi in the fucking head, gave a fucking knot.
Yeah. He like elbowed her like purposely.
No, as
he was trying to break.
Okay, so that's
the
how
video,
that not happened.
Cardi is coming at that bitch like a bull, mm-hmm. at a few people. Like at one point, she clicks out coming at a few people, and Nicki is like ducked off kind of in the corner, mm-hmm. like just like hide behind the rest of the security, and she also hiding behind her Robin. Now, Robin is a joke for people that watch that Whitney Houston Bobby Brown biopic. Ra Ali.
That's why I've been hearing the name Ra Ali. That's the first time I even heard
Everybody
that name.
I have no idea who this
yeah,
is.
Yeah, but so like she's apparently that's who.
That's how Nicki Minaj is Robin.
I didn't know that, but apparently that's who took the lick or some shit, or who was really running up, because people thought that it was Nicki running up as well. Mm-hmm. But no, it was the Ra Ali person that was running
she
up.
She stepped in front of Nicki like
yeah,
like
had to
like,
break
this
him
is
up,
my bitch.
I didn't know any of that. So that's so Nicki has a Robin.
So Devin,
you know Robin is.
I'm gonna break down who Robin is to you, Devin. So Robin was Whitney Houston's childhood.
My whole name on this podcast, but it's all right. Go ahead.
Your name is Robin?
No, like you keep on saying Devin, like Devin.
Oh, okay. I didn't even catch it.
I am not used to hearing my name like that. Like,
all right, D.
Thank you.
So Robin is Whitney Houston's childhood friend, and it's always been strong speculation from her career. And from how Whitney's documentary and Bobby Brown's biopic.
Oh, the one that people thought Whitney might have been dealing with?
Yes.
Oh, okay, yeah.
All right. Bobby said in his book, straight up, Whitney was fucking bisexual, and that was a problem. Just specifically because Robin was always there. Yeah. You know what I mean?
I was so overprotective. Said,
why are you always here? That was joke. I was like, I'd have been felt that even if Whitney wasn't fucking her, dog, if there's a female friend of yours that's always around.
Yeah, somebody you always here.
My nerves would be so bad. I just want to kick it with my girl. Just meet my girl. Go away, please.
Yeah,
if you fucking her, I don't care. Go away. We're married now.
Right.
She will summon you when she wants you. Go
away.
Right.
You don't get fucked. Just wait your turn.
So this is who Rock. Ali is.
To Nicki, apparently.
That's what everybody's calling it.
Okay.
That's what social media is calling
it. That's
the
T.
And she's the one that kind of jumped up to, like, get Nicki back?
Yeah.
Okay, that was a little... Okay.
Now, this is the reason why. Do you know the reason why Cardi came at Nicki?
Yeah, because I'm about to read it specifically.
Okay,
Here's Cardi B's response.
I read that. Yeah,
so this is Cardi B's response about everything. Because Nicki, she putting up these pictures on freaking Instagram, is unbothered trying to blah, blah, blah. But I'm like, at some point, you're going to have to like answer for some of this.
Because
she just threw it at you. So Cardi B says, I let a lot of shit slide. I let you sneak diss me. I let you lie on me. I let you attempt to stop my bag. I fuck up the way I eat. You threatened other artists in the industry. Told them if they work with me, you'll stop fucking with
them.
I let you talk big shit about me. I addressed you once in person. I addressed you a second time in person. And every time, you copped a plea. Mm. When you mention my child, you choose to like comments about me as a mother. Make comments about my abilities to take care of my daughter is when all bets are fucking off. I worked too hard and came too far to let anybody fuck with my success. Bitches talk all that shit in their raps, but in real life, they pussy. This shit really is for entertainment. And the only thing she put on, and then she put period as her caption for her Instagram post or whatnot.
So, I cannot hold her up, though.
Check this out. I already can't, and I've been looking on social media to find where Nicki Minaj has said something about
me
the tour.
Me too. I've been
can't
looking.
Find it.
Culture.
Huh?
Culture.
What about culture?
That's the child's name, right?
Yeah.
You're not saying culture. You're just saying
culture.
Couture.
You said couture on here?
Yeah.
It's culture. I mean, I hope you know it's culture.
I'm just trying to help.
I didn't even know he said that shit.
A couple of times. I'm like, couture?
No. Yeah.
I thought he was talking about something else.
It's culture.
It's culture.
With a K.
It's named after the album.
That's why I thought it was like couture.
Son, we had a whole conversation on here when she first named them culture because we was joked out because they named them after the Migos album. Yeah, saying that. We named that episode for the culture. You said that for the culture. This nigga get too high.
As you can see, I ramble off a little bit sometimes, too.
Damn.
But, culture.
Culture.
I can't find anything she said about culture or couture. And I don't know. I can't say. Only Cardi B and people in the industry knows how she tried to stop her bag and all
she
that.
She ain't flipping out for no reason.
But I tell you this. This is a part of Nicki's record, because this ain't the first artist who said this about Nicki.
No, it's not.
This is one of the first biggest artists who get the name to have a platform like y'all.
Nigga, the radio city. Shows, so there's some DJs say she said some shit like that. You know what I mean?
Radios,
like
radios, DJs,
Nicki be doing some bullshit.
Lil' Kim, you know what I'm saying? I ain't never really seen Trina and Nicki Minaj work on a song together. And I wonder why that is, you know what I'm saying? But
Don't speak too soon. They might have one.
Right, you're right.
You know what I mean?
But I mean, even Lil' Kim and Nicki got one, but that one.
I mean, Lil' Kim don't fuck with her neither. Right. But it's just, you know, we've spoken in depth on Nicki many times. We don't have to rehash old shit about her. But it was just a trip that, like, this was like some surprising news. Like, it was like happened late last night. You get online.
I'm a little disappointed in Cardi.
And there's this whole Cardi B and Nicki fight. And you're like, whoa, fighting. And then you see it was a skirmish. You want to fight. But it still was like, it was the first time we got actual direct proof that there is a problem. Mm-hmm. We've been seeing subs.
Speculations.
Heavy hints. You know what I mean? All kind of sub disses all throughout the music.
Sneak dissing like
all kind of shit, but they always deny.
I ain't had the strip to get the pole position.
Come on, son. Like, Nicki's last album,
she never said nothing until, like, maybe in the recent times in, like, blogs and, like, on MTV at the VMAs. She never said nothing about Nicki trying not to have this beef.
Well, Cardi has been trying not to have this beef.
Going high when Nicki was going low.
You hear me? So the fact that this happened, I'm not even going to blame Cardi because she was even saying she was pregnant. Motherfuckers coming at me because I'm pregnant. Wait till I'm not. She said that a while ago. And I ain't know she was talking about Nicki, but it was an interesting quote. I remember that.
Very.
I'm a little disappointed in Cardi B. Only because this. Cardi B, I understand some things are innate and won't ever change. Like if you see a bitch, some things are on sight. But I also want to know that as you rise up in money and in style and this and the third, pick your times when you want to kick that ass. You know what I mean? That time, I understand how you felt in the anger. But, and looking back hindsight, I don't know if you feel like it was 100, you'll do it again. That's, you know, that's you. And I ain't going to ever get mad at you. I just know that, and I'm not going to use the word disappointed because I'm not here to
judge
you.
I'm about to say, like, I can't be disappointed.
I can't be disappointed at all, dog.
I just know that catch that hoe in and out. You know what I'm saying?
I know, you know what, on some nuanced shit, I understand a level of disappointment, not in a judging way, but in a way of, damn, Cardi, I didn't want this news story for
right,
you.
Right, I don't want this for you.
Yeah. You hear me?
It's not like this, not here.
You're right. I would have rather you got her somewhere else because, like, you've been...
She was patient,
you've been winning. She has been... No, no, no.
She has been patient.
I'm just saying, if I'm going to give anything into the realm of disappointment, I'm going to give it to the level... I'm going to give it to the level of... Damn, Cardi, like, if there was any way around it, I wish there was a way around it because you've been winning, you've been looking swag. If you follow on Instagram, she'd be at all these little Met Gala balls looking swag.
She put this one picture up,
she was, like, front row at one of the little, like, them fashion things, and she was looking beautiful and elegant, and she put, y'all would not believe how far I've come. I can't believe I made it this way. I was so inspired by that picture because, you know what I mean? I'm like, damn.
She said that with a bunch of people, dog, who I know are big in the fashion industry that I don't know.
And it's Cardi fucking B from the fucking hood. Me and Raheem was having that same feeling we was watching Bobby Brown from the projects. Like, we like Bobby Brown from the Jets, and look what he became. And you know what I mean? When you see these people from the hood, from the bottom, rise up to these spots, you can't help but get inspired because we from New Orleans, nigga. We black niggas from New Orleans.
From the fucking bottom.
Son, so it's just like when I see this shit, so it's like that's what makes you innately used to root for Nicki and currently root for Cardi B to a degree. You know what I'm saying? But that's the only part I cast into to disappointment because, yeah, like you just said, D, she been so patient. And a lot of times these celebrities don't know when they will see each other or be in the same place with each other. And she's such a new mother that I understand how those things.
She's a new mama.
She a new mama. And I put up with all this other shit. And now I watched you. From somewhere she heard Nicki was talking shit about her. Also, she already alluded to the fact that someone else was talking shit about her. This and Nicki petty has been liking what other people say. So it's not even that you saying something specifically, even though she most likely heard something. You being petty, liking when random people talk about my motherhood.
Right.
Like it's you ain't
offense after offense, nigga. After offense. I will never.
New mom on them hormones, nigga. What you saying, D?
All of the only thing I am saying is I don't care who it is. I will never hold you up for people like selling your reputation or your child, dog. Like you got the right to defend that shit 24 hours a day, 7 days a fucking week, dog. And if you finally see the person after basically months of just like watching them talk shit about you, if you felt like you had to throw a fucking shoe,
throw that
just to do something, just to fucking get the point across, like
I ain't the one.
I'm not fucking with this.
Right.
Throw the fucking shoe.
That patience had to be blown for her to like. Cause the thing
she had to do something, dog.
People want to say, you know, she ghetto, she ratchet, and the thing is, ghetto, right? Nah. She knows what it is to have class.
She's been showing it.
Right.
Because some people been jumping on this thing. She's so classless for that. I'm like, dog, Nicki. Cardi been showing y'all class. But don't let her slip up, try to make a judgment like and denounce her growth.
Right.
This girl been growing. You've been watching that growth. So don't hate, like, dude, she just had a fucking slip up. And I can't front to you. You about to say something, Joe. What you about to say?
Same thing. I feel like you're on the same track, dog. Like, you know, going to the level of kids and all that in the third, especially in new motherhood, dog, and the fact that mothers over their children in general are very protective.
You know, my mom is still protective.
Very aggressively protective,
yeah,
for the
man.
Most part. Because, like, I see women who are timid about themselves and their own well-being, but behind their kids, will click out.
Wait, pause.
People get beat.
Wait, pause. Speaking of moms, listened to our last couple of podcasts recently because she fell off and listened to us for a minute because she used to freaking live, like, chat me while she was listening to us. So she hit me up recently. She was, like, so in love with my whole conversation about homeschooling. And she listened to sideA, the last one. It was, like, big up on us, giving us props. I was like, Mom, you should send an email in. But I'm going to just say, thank you, Mom.
All right, Mom.
Not because now not only did you listen, you came back with feedback and was, you know, et cetera, et cetera, and stuff. So, you know, appreciate that, Mom. Back to you, Joe. My bad. When you said moms, like, oh, yeah. Moms, I forgot to say that at the top of the show.
Moms are aggressive, dog. I was saying that there's women who probably like who sometimes will take a beating from a husband, but if you hit their kid, they'll click out and kill you.
Yeah, man.
They'll take the lick and be like, you know what, I'll get you later, but you hit their kid, they'll kill you.
Yeah, man.
And so, in that moment, you can't really say, you know, that she was all the way classless or she's a classless person because that was a moment of, like you say, of opportunity. And a built-up frustration, meeting its peak.
And I cannot say I wouldn't do the same in that position,
dog.
All three of us are very down-to-earth niggas, dog. So I can say I can speak for all three of us in this situation, son. I know it's going to be... If I was to blow, it would be hard for me to play that game.
Because this ain't no regular nigga either, dog. Because the people treat it like, you should be bigger than that. You should be bigger than that. But Nicki is a star on a platform that can ruin you. This ain't no regular person you catch a meeting up in the street, dog.
And I'm just saying, just the level of, like, she's been playing that game for a long time, trying to be cool. And I'm just saying, if I was in that position, in the game, and there's this other motherfucker that's bigger than me, as I'm trying to rise, keep poking at me, and talking shit. And I'm trying to be cool. They keep fucking with me. And I'm trying to be cool. And then I hear, like, what she's saying. Now they telling people, don't hire me. Or they saying, don't fuck with me. Or don't stand me. I could not imagine being who I am as a person. And I feel like I can speak for y'all, too, as well. You know what I mean? At some point, you gonna have to address it.
I'm about to say, you gonna get addressed.
She said twice, I've come to you in your face.
That's my whole thing. That is my whole thing. Like, I respect offline shit. You know what I'm saying? Like, if you got a problem, you go physically to that person and be like, bitch, what's happening?
Straight up.
And you done this shit two times, and both times, she tried to play the shit off like she don't know what you fucking talking about.
What you talking about?
I don't respect that. I do not respect that shit. That is trying to get your ass whooped.
Yep.
No, I do not like that shit, dog. Like, she was 100% real about the shit. She tried to fucking address it and squash it because they could have squashed it if Nicki would have copped to it. But she never copped to the shit, and now the shit just got escalated and escalated. She and you tried got a fucking have, shoe thrown at you.
She tried to have class. That's basically what's being proven. I tried to have class offline with you.
Right.
I tried to have class offline with you.
But you played me to the fucking left like it wasn't shit. So, nah, bro. She was getting thrown. You're lucky you didn't get fucking snuck.
But Nicki still is the winner at this moment about this because she was able to, like, put this kind of negative light on Cardi while she sits back and not do anything and look like, oh, I'm not, you know, why am I even in
this? Let's see where it goes. It's still so new, we don't know where it's going to land. I understand how it could go in that direction, but could people still love Cardi so much? And just how we're talking about, damn, did Nicki really say that? Like, there's a way that right now Cardi's getting some heat, but she could end up on top.
Let me say that, how this is going to go.
Underdog shit.
Drake had, who booked him, who said him out of that Pusha T beef?
Jay Prince.
Nicki Minaj going to get Wayne. You know, Wayne gonna run it with Offset on some bullshit, and they're gonna have a meeting with Wayne and Cardi B and Offset, and Wayne gonna be like, listen, baby, I'm sorry about all that. Let's do an album, me and you together. You know what I'm saying? We ain't gonna put Nicki on there. I already told her about that, and ain't gonna be no more about this. And just y'all don't do this no more. I bet you.
I don't see that happening because of egos and issues. And you gotta remember this at this point, like, see, Offset's her husband, but he don't run her career.
No, he don't.
You feel me? So it's like, and she's currently the bigger star. So,
whoa, she is not the biggest star.
Currently, Cardi B is the bigger star.
No. Why do you feel like that? Like, stats-wise, no. Or just no. Personal feeling?
She's getting to this level of, you can ask your average white person, you know Cardi B? Yeah, I know Cardi B. You know Offset? Don't know Offset. You know Migos? Yeah, we know Migos. They might,
okay,
you know
okay, what I'm okay, saying? Okay, like, okay, okay,
niggas
okay.
Know Cardi B the entity on some average person
in
shit.
In the context of Offset versus she's a bigger Migos, star right now. Then yes.
She's a bigger star. Migos is huge. Hell yeah. Everybody know Migos.
I
can't hold
star.
Up on that.
Migos is the star.
I can't say nothing.
Migos is a bigger star than Cardi. But Cardi is a bigger star than Offset. Yeah, than her husband. That's by himself. Fact. Straight up. So I'm just saying, like, right now, like, and if her fangs out and she on some motherhood shit, these niggas ain't about to stop her. Whoever's her business manager, whoever's her handler, whoever actually handles her and her money, that's who you probably would have to talk to versus her husband. Like you said, husband could probably butter some shit up. I feel you on that level, but
I mean, on some beef shit, not the PR shit, on some beef shit. You know what I'm saying? Like, squash the beef.
I understand what you're saying.
Because I feel like Cardi B ain't about to stop right now.
But I'm saying Nicki not even going to take licks. She don't take licks.
That's the problem, dog. Just take
you got L, Cardi man. On. Cardi is right. She, like, even though she threw this, she lost her cool, she's still right on the level of my nigga. Like, you've been doing this shit to sabotage me. This is me acting out.
Sabotage.
And you won't even admit you've wronged me.
Like, you be telling other artists not to work with Cardi, dog. Like, that is so underhanded, dog.
Even without these niggas, even without Wayne and Offset, son, if Nicki would just be real and be like, look, boom, boom, bam, most likely Cardi be like,
this shit could have been squashed ages ago.
But she don't want to.
Whoever caps too is going to feel like they're losing power and, you know, image and shit. So, you know, she don't want to. She don't want to cap to this shit, dog.
A long ago of a podcast that Nicki is trash as far as who she is as a person. I thought she was trash. She started becoming more and more trash each day.
Big ups to you for trying to get some publicity about throwing Geoffrey Owens 25 stacks.
That's why I put it was a good thing for Geoffrey Owens and a good thing for her.
Why did you have to, once again, it's not offline. Why did you have to make that a deal? And then you started attacking a woman who took the picture. But the thing is, do your research, Nicki.
How the hell, niggas, Geoffrey Owens, you about to give him 25K? Why are you doing this?
For publicity, for attention.
Publicity. That is cleanup crew, son. That's cleanup crew. You're trying to, you know, polish up your image a little bit more.
That's the license
arms
coming in to clean up.
And that 25 ain't shit.
And then she tried to run, she tried to make a big deal about the woman who took it. But what I'm saying is, you got to do your research before you do that, Nicki, because the woman who took the picture, Geoffrey Owens, already, like, copped to apologize and saying she ain't mean to, like, her intent wasn't to job shame. It was really shock because she, like, well, damn, like, you, like, she really was ignorant of how you could be on TV and still need a job, but not on the level of how dare you work there.
She didn't purposely job shame, but she did job shame.
She was just surprised. Like, you know what I mean? Wow, he's working at Trader Joe's. I wouldn't have thought of it. Maybe, damn, did the Bill Cosby thing really affect everybody that hard? That was the aim she was at. And she even said in her apology, she said,
She wrote a full, lost everything because of Bill.
That's how she took it. And she was like saying, man, she was like, I know I probably should have walked up to him and just had a conversation and just acted, you know, but I was intimidated because to me, he's still famous.
Uh-huh.
And so it was just like, I think I just took a picture and I shouldn't have done that. She like, she copped all her bullshit. So I'm like, this was on the news and
know,
shit.
But you know what that old saying, though? Ask for forgiveness, not for permission. White folks is a mess of that with that shit, dog.
She not a white person.
Damn, she not?
Nah.
Well, my story is negated.
There you go. Try to see. There you go. That's what you get.
Right, I take my L. I'm taking my L.
But I'm saying, Nicki, like, you going in on her after she didn't already, like, kind of went viral apologizing and taking her lick. So now you look like a bully. Yeah, like, leave this unknown lady alone. Right. And you go throw Geoffrey Owens 25 stacks. Apparently, you know how to hop in people's DMs and threaten them, as was made a story a few months ago. How about you hop in his DM and boom, boom, bam, man.
You can mail that to him.
Boom. And then if he ever decides.
If he ever decides
to say something.
Because it just looks weird.
That's
that
class.
This man who's in a highlight right now, who I'm pretty sure isn't your favorite character on the show, the Cosbys, you automatically want to throw him 25K out of nowhere. And 25K is like what he's about to make on one episode with Tyler Perry's giving him of 10 episodes he's about to be on. His residuals will be more than that 25K you're giving him.
Yeah, and big up to Tyler Perry for putting this man on 10 episodes of the Have and Have Nots, man. That was some cool shit.
Yeah, I mean, that was cool.
You know what I'm saying? Like, get gay.
Aretha Franklin loved that show.
Man, a lot of people love that show.
Old black women love that show.
Yes, yes. It has a particular crowd because, like, the average person that I know hates the show. But my mom, my auntie,
40 and up, dog.
My uncles and shit. Like, you know what I mean? Like, after a certain... Yeah, bro. They just love it. I'm like... It's so funny seeing such the opposite reactions from different... what's the word? It's age groups, but that's not...
Factions.
Not factions, but demographics.
Demographics.
But let's move on to the next thing, dog. We got to get into this white-on-white crime that's happening out here in these streets.
Always and forever.
It's an epidemic, man.
So, like, apparently, MGK, Machine Gun Kelly, was going at G-Eazy recently.
What?
Yeah, they was beefing. And then Eminem drops Kamikaze, and he just goes off on Buku motherfuckers on Kamikaze. That's Slim Shady in his ass. And one of the people that caught heat was MGK. And so MGK turned his beam on Eminem and dropped Let's Talk About It joint, which is catchy as fuck. Like, Devil's I fuck God. With it. Like, the no, Devil's God. That's the name of it. Devil God. Wait.
No.
Rap Devil.
Rap
because,
Devil.
Because Eminem is the rap God. Yeah. So he put Rap Devil out.
Okay.
Which is
kind of cool.
Okay, but if you look at the story, God made the devil, and he's going to win.
I mean, God did, but like, dog, like I said, MJ, watching the video version of the this song is Eminem is like watching a little Eminem come at Eminem. It's like, you look like his son, like for real, get mad at dad.
Wow.
But the diss is nice.
The diss is nice.
Yeah,
his son's betrayed well.
All the smoke for him.
Oh, like Machine Gun Kelly came at him, nigga. You heard it?
No.
Oh my God, he came at him. Let's see what we got here.
Yeah, we're going to pull it up.
Let's talk about it. I just want to keep calling Let's Talk About It. It was Rap Devil. And I do want to say, I like Kamikaze album. Some people trying to say it's trash and shit. That album is not trash. It's not like the epic beat best album of Eminem, but it's not, no, it's a cool album to ride to.
Joe Budden, I don't know.
Joe Budden, Crooked Eye spoke about, we're going to get into the Joe Budden situation of all that after we get to his Machine Gun Kelly. And Joe Budden has some shit to say. But,
I didn't hate Kamikaze all the way fully, so I'm not going to get my full opinion on it.
But one want to say about Kamikaze or what Eminem. But one thing that one rapper said this recently that I had to take into account too when we talk about Eminem is he a white boy. I think we talked about this once. I think we did. He a white boy. So his story, he's a white boy that came up as a white boy and like a poor white boy. So just like how some things that Pac might have spit won't speak to everybody, or something that Kanye might have spit won't speak to everybody. I understand why like some people like, nigga, this his point of view. If you don't speak to you, I could get it because this is white boy talking this white boy story. So if you ain't into it, you ain't into it. It is what it is. But you can see that Machine Gun Kelly, he's a little M.
But apparently he's like from out of the hood instead of out of trailer park.
Both hood, dog.
Funny one is a little different, though, I guess.
Both hood.
There's white people that grew up in the hood, and there's white people that grew up in the trailer park.
Eminem grew up around with a bunch of black people in black trailer parks, though.
They were country. You know
what I'm saying? That's what I'm saying. He still grew up around mainly black people. He was the only white kid in the majority of his schools. Like, he didn't just grow up. He grew up a bunch.
I mean,
like,
both of them still got crime and drugs.
Yeah, but that's true too. But what I'm saying is still, even with it,
a little culture difference with certain trailer parks versus certain people growing up in hoods.
Yeah, but
because them country hood white boys that live in like Mandeville is different from the hood white boys that really grew up in the hood in New Orleans.
Yeah, but Mandeville, they're kicking it with a bunch of white boys that's in the hood. Eminem getting around a bunch of
hoods in Mandeville.
You're true that, but I'm just saying Eminem grew up around a bunch of black people in Detroit. Like that, that's not like we just saying he was in some Tuskegee random ass shit with all
Wyoming
these
and shit.
Yeah, these poor ass white boys. No, he grew up getting bullied and beat up by black kids and shit. Like, he might have one white homeboy. Like, you know what I'm saying?
He was the white homeboy.
That's what I'm saying. I'm not going to take away that from him. You did? Because, like, that's by all accounts, like, he was the white boy. Everybody else was black and shit. But, yeah, man, let's talk about this. Machine Gun Kelly, Rap Devil. Skip this ad. Fuck you.
Yeah, fuck that. Let's see what's happening.
Here's some lines here. Here's some
everything
lines.
Is tatted up.
Like M for the new age.
Marilyn
Manson made a kid. Even though his name is not original.
Hey, somebody grab me some clippers. This fucking beard is weird. Tough talk from a rapper paying millions for security a year. I think my dad's gone crazy. Yeah, Haley, you right. Dad's always mad, cooped up in the studio, yelling at the mic. You sober and bored, huh? I know, about to be 46 years old, dog. Talking about, I'ma call a trick. Man, you sound like a bitch. Man, I can handle your shit. Mad about something I said in 2012. Took you 6 years and a surprise album just to come with a diss. Homie, we get it. We know that you're the greatest rapper alive. Fucking dweeb, all you do is read the dictionary and stay inside. Fuck rap god, I'm the rap devil. Come a bare face with a black shovel like the Armageddon. When the smoke settle, his body next to this instrumental. I'm saying, I'm sick of them sweatsuits and them corny ass, let's talk about it. I'm sick of you being rich and you still mad, let's talk about it. All of us single dads from the Midwest, we can talk about it. Or we can get gully, all size up your body and put some white chalk around it. Talk about the fact you actually blackball a rapper that's twice as young as you. Let's call Sway, ask why I can't go up to shape 45 because of you. Let's ask Gittoscope how you had Paul Rosenberg trying to shelf me. Still can't cover up the fact your last 4 hours as bad as a selfie. Now tell me, what are you staying for? What? I know you can't stand yourself. I'm trying to be the old you so bad you stand yourself. Let's leave all the beef in the 50. Please, damn, you're pushing 50. Why you claiming I'ma call Puff when you the one that called Diddy? Facts. Then you went and called Jimmy. Facts. The conference called me in the morning. They told me you mad about a tweet. You wanted me to say sorry. I swear to God I ain't believe him. Please say it ain't so. The big bad bully of the rap game can't take a fucking joke. Oh, you want some fucking smoke, but not literally, you'll choke. Yeah, I'll acknowledge you're the dope, but I'm the gunner, bitch, I got you in the scope. Don't have a heart attack now. Somebody help your mans up. Knees weak or old age. The real Slim Shady can't stand up. I'm sick of them sweatsuits. Corny ass, let's talk about it. I'm sick of you being rich and you still mad. Let's talk about it.
Like that.
All of a single dads from the Midwest.
Let's talk about it. Talk about it.
We can get gully, I'll size up your body and put some white chalk around it. Hello, Marshall. My name's Colson. You should go back to recovery. I know your ego is hurting just knowing that all of your fans discovered me. Alright. Damn, you're younger me. Except your dress is better and I'm ugly. Always making fun of me. Stop all the thuggery, Marshall. You living in luxury. Look what you've done to me. Dropped an album just because of me. Damn, you in love with me. You got money, but I'm hungry. I like it this, but you won't say them lyrics out in front of me. Shout out to every rapper that's a fun of me. Know that I'll never do you like this fuckery. Still bitter after everyone loves you. Pull that wedgie out your dungarees. I gotta respect the OGs. And I know most of them personally. Hey, but you just a bully acting like a baby, so I gotta read you in nursery. I'm the ghost of the future, and you just have to need a Scrooge. I said I'm flex, anyone can get it. I ain't know it will be you. I'm sick of them sweatsuits and them corny ass, let's talk about it. I'm sick of you being rich and you still mad, let's talk about it. All of us single dads from the Midwest, we can talk about it.
We talk about it.
We can get gully, I'll size up your body and put some white chalk around it. Ride a shoddy, cause I got a road, it's dope. It's a fast road. When your idols become your rivals, yeah. Never hesitate to say it to your face. I'm an asshole.
Bitch, asshole. Fuck
you. We know you get nervous, rabbit. I'll be mama spaghetti all over your sweater. I wish you would lose yourself in the records that you made a decade ago. They were better. According to them, you're a national treasure. To me, you're a soft as a feather. The type to be scared to ask Rihanna for a number. Just hold her umbrella. Ella.
I'm not afraid.
Okay, Oscar the Grouch. Chill on the couch. You got an Oscar. Damn, can anyone else get some food in their mouth? For real. They made a movie about you. You and everybody's top 10. You're not getting better with time. It's fine. Eminem, put down a pen. Or write an apology over the simple fact you wear the disc to acknowledge me. I am the prodigy. How could I even look up to you? You ain't as tall as me. 5'8", man. I'm 6'4". 7 punches, hold your head still. Last time you saw 8 Mile was at home on a treadmill. You were named after a candy.
I was named after a gangster. And don't be a sucker and take my verse off of Yellow Wolf's album. Thank you, thank you. I just wanna feed my daughter. You try to stop the money to support her. You don't wanna always talk about the action. Text me to Addy, I'm pulling, I'm scrapping. And I'm by my fucking self, what's happening? ESD Captain, salute me and shoot me. That's what he's gonna have to do to me when he realizes that it ain't shit he can do to me. Everybody always hated me. This isn't anything new to me. Yeah, there's a difference between us. I got all of my shit without Dre producing me. I know you're not used to me. Usually one of your disses should ruin me. But bitch, I'm from Cleveland. Everybody quiet this evening. I'm reading a eulogy. He dropped an album called Kamikaze. So that means to kill him. Already fucked one rapper's girl this week. Don't make me call Kim. I'm sick of them sweatsuits and corny ass. Let's talk about.
Yeah, and he's I think he's supposedly smashed the easy girl.
Kim Kardashian?
No, Kim. Eminem Kim. X. Kim. We always rap about. Fuck you, Kim. Big Kim.
I'm about to say, like, I haven't, you know, thought about, you know.
And, like, rumor has it MGK did fuck Jeezy girl or somebody girl he was beefing with. And it was some funny shit.
I wouldn't doubt. I mean, they in a rap game.
But, yeah, no, that's a really, really nice diss.
That's a solid diss, that's dog. That's solid. I like the track. I like its cadence. Solid. I like the video.
Solid.
You know what I'm saying? Solid. Like, I like the whole shovel thing. Like, that was cool. I like it. I like it, dog. And it sounds like you spitting straight facts. You know what I'm saying?
We had to always add this. There's always going to be some exaggeration in the battle. But yeah. You spitting that real. You making me believe you.
Yeah, you are very believable.
You hear me?
Like, and some things like that he got a reason to be saying all this shit.
And to give some context, apparently he said some disrespectful shit to Haley, like in 2012. Basically said he was trying to smash and shit. So that pissed off M. And so M was telling them niggas, man, y'all better get you. Like he apparently did tell like some higher ups, like y'all better get your boy before I get him. So that's what he's referring to about you call these people looking for apology. I don't know if he's looking for an apology. That's what I'm saying. Some of that shit is gonna be some rap shit that you're gonna say to dig into a nigga. But some of the truth about that is you did say that shit about his daughter. He did have a motherfucking problem. Apparently said some shit about it. Let's hear M's side when M talked that shit. I don't know what M gonna say, but this was a solid diss. Cause M maybe gave him maybe two or three bars on his album. Because really, M was going at a lot of all the little white boys,
What track was that you talking about? That's on M. He's going at him.
I think it's called Fall. It's like two tracks that he's talking about the different people that's biting him and shit like that. And
M is gonna have to come with a response.
M hasn't come with a response yet, but the one that made MGK respond fully. Is the one he got with Royce the 5'9", and that's the Not Alike.
Okay, that's one, Not Alike. Because he got two main songs, Fall, and I guess that's the other one, Not Alike, where he giving it to niggas.
Not Alike, he really gives to MGK.
You know what I'm saying?
Especially after like how MGK feel about this and watching him, you could tell like, oh man, this is... But...
M gave him a few bars on there, though. He ain't give him no, like, this is a song.
M has a song.
You know, like, compared to another one?
But he said something about all the white rappers on Not Alike. It was like MGK, he talked about, it was a few of them, and I was like, oh, okay, so.
He has to make an MGK-specific song. Like, this is an Eminem-specific diss. He has to come with an MGK-specific one. Like, fuck MGK.
I'll say this.
You know?
Yes, it was solid. I'm gonna give you the words of Bizarre from D12.
With me inside my head.
That was a solid diss track. It was really good.
It was really good. It
came with some great stuff, and it was good for the culture.
Yes, indeed.
It was well appreciated.
Yep.
But boy, what you about to unleash is about to just destroy everything you think about.
Because I don't believe M would say names and not be prepared for... to diss whoever the fuck name he said.
And it's not, I don't know if Em did all that fucked up shit personally, but just on lyrics alone, my nigga, you have met a master swordsman. I hope you blade sharp. Because this right here is a good battle. It's a good one. But this ain't master level yet.
If Eminem do make a song about MGK, I know it's going to be that sauce. Like, I know it's going to be like...
Oh, if it Meek Mills this shit, I'll be drove.
It would be disappointing. It would be a disappointment, but, you know, knowing M's rap sheet, no pun intended, you know, he will come with that shit, for sure. Like, if he does, like, choose to get specific about this dude, shit.
Sriracha, nigga.
It's gonna be...
Now, the other big name that's come out to say something out of all the people Eminem dissed on Kamikaze was Joe Budden. Now, Joe Budden is currently retired. Joe Budden, I'm a fan of his music. Joe Budden is a beast rapper. He's in, you know, he transitioned to podcasts and shit. And the big line that everybody is taking, because I listened to this whole podcast talking about the whole situation. Mm-hmm. And he said that he feels like for the past decade, he's been better than Eminem.
Mm-hmm.
And he feels like he has not been impressed with Eminem over over a decade. Because you remember, he was with Slaughterhouse and that was Science of Shady for a second. He got into all the background details on that. And he just been saying, like, basically, like, He been following Eminem for a while, and at a point, like, he been stopped being impressed or being like, oh, about Eminem. So to him, M ain't much shit. And he was like, and M really just gave him like a bar too as well. Well, he gave Machine Gun Kelly more bars than he gave Joe Budden, but he really just gave Joe Budden like a bar. But Joe Budden was like, that bar was weak. Don't come at me. If you come at me harder, if you come at me legit, if you come at me harder, then I'm going to eat your face. Because Joe Budden basically said, I'm going to eat you. Like, I'm ready to eat you. I've been ready to eat you. I've been ready to put you in your place, et cetera, et cetera.
This sounds like another nigga in training ready to fight the master again.
Yeah. I like Joe Budden. Like you said earlier, Bats, dude. Like, I think Joe Budden is a great rapper, dog. Like, he had his moment. You know what I'm saying? But I think if M chose to go at Joe Budden, he would also eat Joe Budden for breakfast, lunch, and fucking dinner, son.
I think Joe Budden give him a fight, dog. Joe Budden...
He might give him a fight, Joe but he's Budden not going to win.
Funny enough, Joe Budden's had more on-wax beefs than M. He has more experience, I can say that.
Granted, but I think Eminem will fucking slaughter.
I think Eminem will eat him up, dog. But I think Joe got some shit. Cause that's one thing I will say this that gives Machine Gun Kelly, even a Joe Budden, a certain advantage to a degree. When you a nigga that's the biggest one, there's more information on you for a nigga to use. Yeah. And that's where the deficit comes. You know what I mean? Yeah. Like if I'm Jay-Z and you just some minuscule nigga, if I'm trying to find shit on you, it's
very easy to do. Yeah.
It's hard for me to find shit on you if I'm Jigga, but if you try to find shit on me, you got plethora of shit. So that's the only spot where I could be like, man, nigga could hit him up just off that. You know what I mean? And then Joe, a nigga that come with some personals and shit.
I think the thing is, Joe will come with a good fight.
He will
come with a good fight.
I don't even say he'll come with a great fight.
No, an amazing fight. I don't know.
He's going down in nine.
I don't know. I don't know in 2018 where that would go. That's what I'm gonna say. Like 12
round bout, he going down in nine.
I'll be rooting for him, but I'll be looking at Joe like, oh shit, Joe. You know what I'm saying? But and Joe also said that he's like been better over the past decade, which can be debatable because the past decade means from 20.
Highly debatable.
But that means from 2008 to now. And
that was when we first met.
Hmm.
That was when we first and I'm met. Saying that's a long time ago.
It is a long time ago, but it's also if I'm looking at Eminem albums, like, you know what I'm saying, Eminem albums are a range of misses,
ups and downs,
ups and downs of galore. Because
I feel like after the what you call them, the Eminem show, it was a bunch more misses.
After Eminem show, it gets dicey. But at the end of the day, one thing Eminem always proves is his talent. Like, that's one thing. Whether you love his album or not, you cannot deny his spitting ability. It's like what people say about Three Stacks, which is why they still mention Three Stacks with the greats. It's because even though he was on Outkast, even though he was in a group, people still be like, but look what he did. When you look at Eminem, even if his album was whack to you, even if you couldn't connect with it, but look at the skill, though. Like, you know what I mean? If this is not your type of music, look at the skill. And that's one thing he could always prove. And
he can rap and make songs, dog.
And Joe Budden felt like he said also that M ain't been providing no real content, just been doing rippity rappity shit over the past decade. And I would challenge that. Now, his last album, I didn't like his last album that much. It was kind of boring, but his last album was filled with a bunch of content. And Joe Budden, one thing that started the beef with Joe Budden, with Eminem in this case, in this incarnation, Joe Budden had a scathing review for Eminem's last album before Kamikaze. I mean, like, destroying it, trying to, because Eminem had some woke songs, Eminem had all this shit. He was basically saying that, you know, Eminem trying to use black culture and black issues to be relevant. I mean, like, he came for M in a way that even Crooked Eye was like, son, like, the way, like, Crooked Eye, because when Joe Budden was talking about Slaughterhouse, Crooked Eye was part of Slaughterhouse, and Crooked Eye came out recently and was like, look, yo, like, anybody listening to Joe Budden, I also noticed that that's my dog, but there's a certain bias that he has as well because he feels a personal way about Eminem, too.
That's what I was going to say.
He was like, man, if you're going to judge that man's music, you got to judge this man's music without your bias. Yeah. And he was like saying some of the ways you judge that album crossed some lines that was not just music. Mm-hmm. It was, you got a problem with Eminem and nigga could smell that off that review, which is why you got the diss.
Yeah.
So don't act like you just being objective here. But one thing I will say this, Joey did start off the podcast saying, look, I'm not going to be objective here. So I'm always give that caveat. If you tell me off the dump, you go have a bias. I'm going to always look at what you said
with a bias.
Knowing that you're not.
A slight thing to that.
So it's interesting, son, but Joey basically said to Eminem, I'm not going to come out of retirement for that bullshit that you said. That was garbage. You send me another, you feel froggy, I'm going to eat you. It was one of those things of, it was a threat. There's no other way to put it. Mm-hmm. It was a threat, nigga. It's like, I dare you to make a song about me.
Daring,
because if you do, I will destroy you completely. Big words.
Big words, though. Hope you can back it up, Doc.
I don't know if M gonna say something. I'm wondering if M gonna say something to him. I hope M would.
Think new M would?
I don't know.
Maybe not, but I hope he does.
If you took the time to diss him, say his name, because that's the thing. You had a degree where if you say anyone's name, even say Charlamagne's name, because Charlamagne didn't like something that he did. But I'm saying, if you're gonna say someone's name and willing to give them that kind of light and that kind of shine,
yeah,
bitch, you already made them worthy to speak on, so you might as well give this man a diss too, as far as I'm concerned. Yeah. He dared you.
Yeah.
But once again, Joey got some heat, son. I didn't watch a lot of Joey beefs. Like, a lot of people didn't pay attention to when he was coming at Drake. That nigga came at Drake. Like,
I think it just, that one went over my head.
Nigga, he had at least 4 diss songs at Drake, and all of them was like,
why was he dissing Drake, though?
Because Drake came at him on some sub shit.
Oh, okay, well. But
Drake didn't ever say this man's name.
But Joe
knew, and so Joe was, and this is before he retired, so Joe popped off. Like I said, from his beef with Saigon, his beef, he came at Jigga. Like, Joey has had these beefs where even if the other person wasn't replying, the diss songs he was producing to make you be like, damn, Joey said some shit. That's the only thing that made me go, like, if he came at M, I know he'll be saying some shit. He can't outflow M. M got the flow. But Joey will have some lines, I know that. So that's just the thing that make this a very interesting beat.
They have a couple of zingers in there.
But I hope you don't get knocked out by MGK Eminem. You my nigga, though. I don't need to see that.
I doubt it. We'll see.
Only
time will tell.
I hope he has a response, man. I hope he responds. Don't say niggas' name, but don't respond. What's up, Joe?
That's it.
Don't be saying niggas.
Don't be calling out Couture. Don't be calling out. Don't be calling out M and Haley. Dare
talk about Couture or Hallie.
But now this is something I real respect about M. He's saying your name, because the Jiggas, the Drakes, there's so many of these big name niggas. Don't be saying names.
And I don't respect that, dog. Like, yeah, I just don't. I don't respect that, dog. Like,
I don't know. Sometimes you gotta be smooth with the jab.
Fuck that. As a nigga that done like extreme street shit, like real street beefs, dog. Like, say what you mean what you fucking say, dog. Like, there's no up to misinterpreting shit, dog. Like, if you really got a problem with a nigga and you're gonna take time to make a whole song with a track and production and all this shit for you to go all the way just short of not saying who you're talking about. It just rubs me as kind of phony, me personally.
I mean, I give certain people a pass, and Jigga is one of the people I give a pass to how he do it, how he dibbles in that bitch like Floyd Mayweather or fucking Sugar Ray or Robert Leonard.
Because Floyd Mayweather is punching niggas in the mouth.
But he's also smoothing out and then getting out of that too, you know what I'm saying? He punching niggas in the mouth, and the niggas who know it's fucked, they getting punched, they know what it is.
Floyd ain't knocking a nigga out in 15 years.
Neither is Jay-Z, because he ain't got no time for that.
No, I'm just saying, Jim, I'm just throwing that out here about Floyd.
But.
No, Jigga still diss what he wants to.
He ain't knocking niggas out. At one point in time, he was knocking niggas out and calling niggas names. Way back when he was like mid-90s.
Nah, Jigga. Jigga kind of always dabbled in both sides.
But I heard him a few times, like, calling niggas names. Like, sometimes he did. Most of the times he did. But sometimes he did. Like,
yeah,
like,
you said he dabbled. I'm saying he dabbled in both sides. I'm not saying nothing different.
I just don't like the style of,
he's not going to give you that pop shit.
I don't like subs.
Yeah, that sub shit. Like, Pac will say your name.
Pac will say everything about you.
Yeah, man. One thing I will say about Eminem is this, dog. Like, you had a career back in the past dissing these pop stars. You gonna diss these rappers, you better be ready for the backlash, and you better be ready to show and prove.
Yeah.
That's all I'm gonna say on that. Like, you're one of my favorite rappers ever, M, but that was a nice diss from MGK. I think Button would be a formidable opponent. Don't come out here acting like you shady and you ain't ready to be shady.
Yeah.
Because niggas will be shady to your ass afterwards.
Straight up and down, son. Let's move to the next thing. Nike endorses Kaepernick, and the white people done gone crazy.
Yeah. And when I first saw it, dude, like, you know, all the outrage and blah, 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 you know, burning shoes and shit, I really thought that it was only white people mad, but, like, they still got coons amongst the fucking outrage, too.
You know what I'm saying? Coons always been woods.
But, I really like the post that you put on your Facebook about how, like, it doesn't really matter what company gave him a shot.
Mm-hmm.
We just happy that he just got a fucking shot.
Because that's, you know, the thing. Like, because that's the thing. Because people will be coming with this, well, y'all too happy, as if Nike. Now, one thing is this. A lot of black people love Nike. it's been a thing about the thing. It's like black people love Nike. So some of the jokes that was coming out was, oh shit, you know what I mean? Well, we got you, Nike. And it made these the people who can't take a joke because, well, actually, Nike is just trying to make money. That's the only thing that they care about. Right. They're still owned by white people and they're just trying to make money off of the I'm like, nigga. I need y'all to understand this, dog. We don't give a fuck who gave Colin Kaepernick this win. Right. We're just happy to see Colin Kaepernick get a win. It could have been Nike. It could have been Reebok. It could have been Empire and Lucius Lyon and them. It could have been Good Burger. It could have been Trader Joe's with Geoffrey Owens. It could have been anybody. Given the homie who's deserved the win after seeing his man get blackballed, after seeing his man do positive shit and get shitted on, after seeing to this day white people still not understanding the true message, after seeing all this shit this man be getting to punch it back towards, seeing a company as big as Nike or anybody back this man publicly and be like, look, we'll give him a job. We'll give him some light. Nigga, we happy for Cap.
Right.
Period.
Can we just celebrate today and go back to work tomorrow?
Fuck. Can we? Can we please?
Now, was that news article true about the guy who burned his house down or was that?
That was untrue.
I figured that.
That was untrue.
I figured that.
It was really a crystal meth lab that was like next to some Nikes.
But like the National Police Organization is calling for a Nike boycott over the Kaepernick hat. And I'm like, cops, dog. Like, see, what kills me about that's so hypocritical, son. The issue is he's kneeling because police brutality is a thing. And you cops are thinking he's kneeling because he hates you. No, he's mad at police brutality. You won't even take the time to look at the nuance to be like, you know what? We do be fucking up. As another, like, another girl was tased recently by this woman cop. To wake her up, you tase the girl or wake her up?
And stupidity. Right?
No, I'm not about to get deep in that. I'm just speaking on like y'all cops ain't even publicly getting better and want to feel some kind of way. Right. Like what? These issues haven't even stopped.
Turn the cameras on and y'all thought it was showtime.
Right. Like I would think that we would not hear as many police brutality or killings.
Oh, dumb ass shit like this.
But it still be stupid ass shit. And I'm like.
Wake up. 100 votes.
And fuck the NFL for all of a sudden talking about we're supporting. NFL released a statement backing players protesting social issues, including Colin Kaepernick.
What?
Yeah.
What? Now, I didn't see this. So the NFL is basically reneging on everything that they're
trying to fight
that
colluding
fucking said.
Case that Kaepernick got.
What that boy just said is
what?
The right answer.
Man, fuck y'all for that, dog.
You hear me?
Fuck y'all.
That boy still had a motherfucking collusion case on these niggas, and they trying not to look bad.
That's corny.
On
that
top of that,
then
most of their brand and material is made by Nike.
And they just got a new deal. They just re-signed a new deal with Nike. Yeah. So it's all now. You want to talk what's money?
Right.
Y'all same niggas talking that shit about, oh, but Nike, blah, blah, blah. Y'all still watching NFL and still supporting NFL, still putting money behind the NFL and won't call NFL on this blatant bullshit.
Right, dog.
I ain't waiting on nobody who wanna watch football. You judge your damn self, but don't come in here with these arguments knowing that you being hypocritical your damn self.
Right, dog.
Come on.
I hate it, dog. That is so blatant. Like, that is so blatantly whack, dog. Like, come on, guys.
What are they saying?
The National Football League believes in dialogue. Really? Huh. I can't even get through this sentence, like, without stopping. Understanding and unity. We embrace the role and responsibility.
Man.
Of everyone involved with this game to promote meaningful positive change in our community.
Then why has it been mandated that we have to stand for the motherfucking what you call the anthem or get fined?
I will
or
grant
fired.
Them that if they change that fucking rule. Change that rule saying that players gotta fucking stand. If y'all change that shit, then I will give you some credence.
Some.
Keywords, some. I'm not fucking with you,
mm-mm.
But I will give you a point where you can get one at.
You know what's funny, dog? It's the fact that he took a knee for something. Because if he would have just sat down regularly, like most, because there's people that do sit down during the national anthem on a football team and don't get this much publicity. It's because he took a knee for something.
And then let's throw this part into it. You got to come a little closer, Joe. But when we got to throw this part into it, too, he first was sitting down.
Yeah.
And no one even noticed he was sitting down. Then he talked to the vet. And the vet said, okay, the respectful way to do that, so it's not just you sitting on your ass, basically, is, you know, take a knee. I think that'd be a respectful way. Me as a vet would be cool with that. So all these people who riding on him for disrespecting the vets, the vet is the reason he's even taking. You even seen him take a knee.
The niggas that say that he's disrespecting the flag and not supporting the vets are niggas who are not vets, who do not been or have not ever been in the military.
I think that's the most frustrating part about this whole thing for me, is how people are actively trying to change the narrative about why people are kneeling. You know what I'm saying?
Like, purposely we like keep missing
on
the message.
Purposely. It's like we keep on saying over and over and over again, it's about police brutality. But they keep trying to say it's about veterans and the flag and blah, blah, blah. It's like y'all are being willfully ignorant, like, despite what everybody is saying, like, despite what the protesters are saying, what they're protesting about.
Out their mouths.
Out of their fucking mouths, y'all are still being like, no, you're protesting about fucking the anthem and the military.
You hate the military. You don't respect the country. You hate America.
It's like, dude, like, the sky is blue. No, you're saying the sky is red. No, the sky is blue. No, you're saying it's red. It's like, the fuck? Like, that's the most frustrating part.
The sky is red, Devin. The sky is red. You bitch.
Jesus. Kill me.
Moving on. You got something else to say, Joe? You better say something. My bad.
Nah, fuck it.
You heard about Mayweather tossing Chris Brown baby mama like 20 stacks?
Yeah, I heard about that stupid shit.
Why?
Because that's nigga shit, because you can't take the nigga out of the nigga.
Nick, look what Joe just said.
Wait, so for Mayweather, let
me clean. Lately,
damn, you rich dude.
Like, I'm like, dog, that's just so petty and messy. Floyd Mayweather gave the mother of Chris Brown child $20,000 to start clothing business.
Oh.
Lately, eyes have been on the child support case regarding Chris Brown and Nia Guzman. The latter states that she is in need of more money from the superstar singer. Chris currently pays $2,500 a month in additional 4 G's to Guzman's mother, but she states that isn't enough. A new wrinkle hits the net today.
$2,500 a month
and an additional 4 G's
to
the grandma.
Basically, 7K.
Because I guess the grandma must watch it too or something, because it's the Guzman's mother. So
I got to check Chris Brown's bank account, but you can do better than that, Chris Brown.
A new wrinkle hits the net today. Floyd Mayweather gave $20,000 to Guzman when she started the clothing business that only makes her $400 per month. The Blast reports Mayweather and Guzman are close friends, and the chat made the investment in RoyaltyBrown.com as a silent friend. And how can we know about it?
Right.
Guzman and Brown are going to court battle over the amount that's being paid for the care of their daughter, Royalty. Breeze recently stated that additional funds would risk his daughter being spoiled. Guzman states she needs assistance with costs that include $3,300 in rent, $3,500 in food, among other costs.
Wait, hold on. So it's $3,300 in rent.
That's what she want.
And $3,500 in food and bills.
And other costs.
It sounds like he's getting that.
They didn't say bills and other costs. That is way more broad than bills. Just saying. Cool.
I mean, what can we include in other costs though?
Nails, hair,
BS.
That happens.
Along
what I'm
with
saying.
Gas.
Real shit and BS.
You know what I'm saying?
As I say, when you say other costs, that makes me see that it's bills and BS. Right, and
right.
BS too.
It sounds like, personally, it sounds like she's getting enough, basically.
I don't know, dog.
I think y'all both right. I think that Chris Brown with his money could pay more, but I feel what you're saying, D, but what she's getting is more than majority of kids, period.
Right.
Like, for real.
Like the vast majority, dude. Like,
I was getting paid $2,500 a month, and on top of it was 4 G's, so $6,500 a month. I wish I could get that.
Nigga, if I could get $65 a month, like, I'd be maxing and relaxing.
Nigga, I wouldn't
like,
care about shit.
Nothing, dog.
But you are, you know what I'm saying, like, I don't know, and me as a dad, I ain't saying I'm about to put the girl up in the fucking, like, the mama in a big-ass super mansion. But, like, if my little girl lived up, I want my little girl to live somewhere, if I can afford it, better than $6,500 a month.
What if
Chris Brown money?
What if that's what that man can fucking afford? Because we really don't know this man's bank account.
I think that man can afford more, and I would like to, I'm just going on the bank on the fact that what it is.
You didn't answer his question. He said, but what if?
What if he can't?
Yeah.
Well, then,
what if that's like actually what he can give?
Then that's it, what it is, then. Ain't nothing to say about that, but if that's the only thing he give.
Because these fees are worked out in court. Like, they got to check your income and everything, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah, you're right about that, but there's certain ways they can play around how they get around with money in court systems, like 50 Cent. You know, they learn how to play around with bankruptcy in Chapter 11 and still
pay. You're talking about bankruptcy, dog. Like,
you talking about money.
I'm talking about child support.
No, you're talking about money, and I'm saying people can find a way on paper to look broke, to pay less, and still not be broke, to eventually be rich.
I don't know about this.
Donald Trump done it.
Seems too alley. Seems alley specific.
50 Cent and Donald Trump are in different tax brackets than Chris Brown, though.
Like, dude, come on,
I'll say that.
Man.
That's big. That's big. Like, that's big
let's
name.
Let's see what his net worth is right now.
That big name. Yeah,
let's see what Chris Brown's net worth is right now. Let's do that.
I didn't really care that much. I was about to move to the next store. But
and don't go to the next store.
You look up his network and such. Cause I'll
show you how to network.
Because either way it goes, like, I understand where both of you are coming from. It's just, like, deep that, because $2,500 a month can take care of a child. Like,
it just can.
Damn sure to take care of mine. But
I'm just saying.
It just can, dog. I mean, $6,500 bucks.
All right, he's worth $50
million. $50 million.
Net worth $50
million. So how much do you think he should be giving her a month?
Chris Brown decided to earn over $4 million yearly at a mark of over $350K a month. That's what they got in this story.
So he makes about $350K monthly?
Mm-hmm. Guzman reports
so
to the
courts. $4 million yearly.
Guzman reports to the courts of having monthly expenses of that, and that's where we read about that. And so, she says she only makes $400 a month from her online clothing business. Well, bitch, you can't get a job. Like, I feel like Chris.
Now he's worth $30 million.
I feel like Chris should toss her more money if he can afford it, because he got millions. So if he can afford it, whatever, son. But
man,
I think
she should be in the house. She shouldn't be paying rent.
She shouldn't be paying rent?
Because rent is something like that. Like, she got to keep paying. Like, you want the little girl to have a stable place. So at some point, whatever.
She should also be working, dog.
She should be working.
Like, that's my thing about it. It's like, I feel you.
You're a multi-millionaire, dog. Like, this one, she can't work, dog.
Regardless,
but dog,
her mama should be working.
She should be working. Like, you shouldn't. My child support should not be keeping you kept.
Right.
If you ain't my girl.
For you to be laying on your ass.
But like, this my little girl here, dog. Like, my little girl wouldn't have to. Like, you stay in the. Nah. You stay in this house. The thing is, we're not on the same terms, but we got the same amount of money, or we in the same kind of struggle. I'm a multi-millionaire. I can buy you a $100,000 house, and I can get that back in the same month.
If
you
have
to pay rent again. At that $2,500 a month for rent,
that
goes down now because you got a house.
Fuck everything.
If you look at
that,
her rent is $3,300, is what she's saying. She don't have to be. She don't have to even be in a spot that's paying that much rent. But I understand what you're saying. You're trying to get your girl, you're trying to get your daughter the best surroundings. I understand all that. And with all of that, I still say she should have a job. She should be working.
She should have a job.
I understand. Like I said, if Chris Brown, he multimillionaire, pay that money. If you could pay that money, Chris, do what you do. I feel what you're saying, Joe.
Would you do it?
Would I make
if
sure?
If you was a multimillionaire and your little girl was staying with her mom's house, would you buy her mother and where she stayed probably half the time?
It depends on my relationship with that lady.
Yeah, that is very dependent.
Because I don't know his relationship with Nia Guzman. I don't know if she tried to kill him or not. I don't know what the situation is that would make me want to or want not to. You know what I mean? Like, if I got my best friend pregnant and we just didn't work out, it's different from I got this little broad pregnant. She give me all kind of crazy drama. And all I really want to do is make sure that my little girl has the best schools, mm-hmm. is fed, da, 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 da. And I can do all of that without giving you all this money to be kept.
Money.
You know what I mean? Because he don't have to give the grandma 4 G's. He get a grandma more than the
grandma watching the kids.
That's what I just said earlier.
It's also crazy. It's like, how is all this even working?
He
like,
breaking off the grandma what the mama want.
Yeah.
Because the mama would say it's about $300 in rent and $3,500 for food. And I'm like, $3,500 for food a month?
And then pause. You can relate to that specifically because given the mama of your child's mother money so you can know where your money is going, maybe he's doing that because somewhere like along the line she was taking money and not spending it on the child maybe, and boom,
it's all speculation.
All speculation. But even that being said, with my same situation, and in some ways I guess it's a power move too, because I know it's everything's certain. If I buy this house, that it is certain my little girl will have this place to stay when she come here. Now, the mother, she's the one who gets a benefit, but it's not for her. My little girl has a house to stay when she goes by her mother. It's my little girl's house. And it probably will be in my little girl's name. You know what I'm saying?
I understand everything you're saying, son, but, like, but I still want this woman working, dog. I'm not paying for you to have a fucking free ride, dog. Especially, depending upon our relationship with each other.
I'm not saying you shouldn't work either. You dig? I'm definitely not saying that. But I'm saying that I was a multimillionaire. That's one thing I probably do the hardest.
I'm not hating on you, son. You're not, dog. Your reasoning ain't wrong. You know what I mean? I ain't saying nothing against what you're saying. I'm just saying that I'm not gonna hit on Chris because he's not doing that. Is what I'm saying.
Right.
I'm saying I can see that there's layers to what, like, he could just be being a selfish bitch. You know what I mean? That could be true. Because once again, with millions, that's not as much to him from the outside looking in. So that's why I'm with you on. You know what? If I had millions, if that's 30, you want 3 G's instead of 2 G's, here go 3 G's, whatever, go away. You know what I mean? I understand that totally, because I'm not a money nigga. I don't care about money like that. I'm afraid to see me rich, because when I get rich, I don't care about money. I just want to live. Right. You get what I'm saying? So, but who knows the reasonings?
All rich people got tight ass pockets.
Who knows the reasonings in his situation? That's the only thing I can give him, and you know what I'm saying? I want the mother of my kid. If we ain't rocking, dog, motherfucker, dog, don't just, like, she has her own business. Nigga, go get a job. Your business ain't working right now. Sorry. You know what I mean? And if you and you know Chris will never let her get evicted. You know what I mean? I don't got to give you over amounts of money
to keep you in space.
You know what I mean? I will make sure you don't get evicted, motherfucker. But you're not about to be stacking this cake on me.
Right.
And off of me and fall, like I said, depending upon their relationship. That's all they can say. Everything else is speculation.
Right.
Truthfully, dog. Yeah. Y'all heard about Young Thug has 8 felonies, dog? He might be going for away for a while.
What are you?
I mean, I hope he beat the charges. They learn better. But 8 felonies, dog.
8 felonies, goddamn.
Nigga.
I heard of a 3-time felony.
Slapped with 8 felonies for drug and gun possession. I was like, all right, Young Thug, you can't be wearing them dresses now, boy. Well, you might be gone.
Hey, maybe we was right. Maybe them dresses was hiding them guns. Like, it was an extra gun holster place, like on Boondocks, where they had the little strap holster.
Maybe. Maybe. See you in the Bats Nerd Out moment, y'all.
Bats Nerd Out moment. Bats Nerd Out.
Bats Nerd Out moment. Bats Nerd Out moment. Bats Nerd Out moment.
Bats
Nerd Out. Bats Nerd Out moment. Bats Nerd Out moment. Bats Nerd Out.
So, Oscars decide not to add the popular category. Remember that shit?
Wait, what?
Oh, yeah, yeah.
The Oscars gonna add a category about most popular.
They put it on hold.
Oh, yeah. Like an actual popularity contest?
An actual movie, because a lot of movies, yeah. A lot of movies get overlooked because, you know, there's Oscar movies. But then there's movies like, you know, like Black Panther or like The Dark Knight, which made like crazy amounts of money and people love, but they're not technically Oscar movies. So
you can't get an Oscar to be Batman.
You hear me? But technically, if it's breaking records in the millions and the millions, they should like
and
get something
by, like, a lot of great critics
for it. Mm-hmm. So that was the fight. That's the two sides of the fight of, okay, damn nigga, like, a movie that made $4 billion should get some kind of award, even if it's not the technical masterpiece of something like that Martin Scorsese Nolan made. So that was a fight, but they decided not to do it as of now. I just found it to be interesting because I think those films should get something. I don't know what to call it. Like you said, the term popular has a bad connotation.
Yeah, it has a bad connotation too.
But it should get something, like, you know?
Just call it something else.
Yeah.
Rebranding. Y'all need to pay people to rebrand their shit. Mm-hmm. Cecily Tyson is finally getting an Oscar.
Oscar. She deserves it, but it's a pity Oscar.
It's honorary.
Honorary award.
I like
alongside
it, I like
Kathleen it. Kennedy, Frank Marshall, Lalo Schifrin, and Marvin Levi. I'm all for it.
I mean, hey, get it, baby. She look good for 93.
Mm-hmm. Right.
By the time she's been recognized for it, dog. It's just, you know.
She has done a lot.
Yep.
She was Miss Jane Pittman.
I fuck with it for the main reason of one of the main reasons why you probably ain't been get an Oscars because of racism.
That's
not because of nothing in your
nothing
control.
Else but racism.
So for and people to go be going back and making to writing those wrongs of, you know what, lady, you are too legendary to not have one, mm-hmm. and we can recognize that it's our fucking complicated past is the reason why you don't. Get a little Oscar, dog. She deserved it. She, mm-hmm. It's not pity because she earned it. She's Cecily goddamn Tyson.
She did earn it.
This ain't somebody who did one or two movies.
Some random
this
scrub,
is Cecily motherfucking
right.
Tyson. She ain't no pity here. You earned it. You're who you are.
Apparently she was nominated in 73.
One time in her career? Come on.
I mean, I'm not.
That don't even.
I'm not saying that makes it okay, but nah. I was just saying it because, like, I never knew that.
I mean, yeah. Angela Bassett was everybody's mama.
Angela Bassett is gonna be another one in like 20 years. They're gonna give her honorary. I bet you any money in like 20, they're gonna give her honorary.
She needs her shit ASAP.
She need one, dog. I mean, like, it's Angela motherfucking Bassett. Like, Like Angela Bassett.
Angela Bassett, nigga. I just started watching American Horror Story Coven.
Yeah.
Oh my God. Why the fuck am I so late on that shit? I fucking love American Horror Story.
She doesn't age either.
Dude.
She looks so good in that show.
That's some good shit right there, dude.
Yeah, man.
Yeah, I was just throwing that out there.
Big ups to American Horror Story. Their new joint, Apocalypse, is about to drop, and a lot of people are hyped about that.
I cannot wait, because I'm actually caught up, so, yeah.
That's the beauty of it. There's nothing to catch up on, because every is anthology. I think that's one of the smartest things to do, if I'm making a show, making an anthology show, so every season, we just do whatever the fuck we want.
Do something different. I think we could fucking do that.
We definitely could.
That's
we definitely could.
Definitely trendsetters of that of doing that.
It's Lino.
Same characters, different concepts.
I think that'd be yeah.
Well, same people, different characters, same different concepts.
But they doing that shit for series, and I think you can live forever. You know how many seasons you could get out of that just anthology concept? What's that one? Black Mirror is another one.
Black Mirror. Yeah, that's awesome.
Mm-hmm. Law and Order has a new show. They're gonna do Hate Crimes.
Hate Crimes.
That's G.
I'm here for it.
I'm kind of here for it, too.
In the city, words like spick, nigger, chink, gook.
I think the first episode has to be a bad police shooting, though.
It most likely will. It's going to be something with niggas.
It's got to open up hard just like that, and then we can go on.
Apparently, this police officer stabbed him with his badge.
And what's Thundercats getting a movie. Ryan Reynolds, Netflix. I did not watch Thundercats.
Really? Mm-mm. It was the shit, dude. I love Thundercats. You come on Saturday morning.
Thundercats was fucking annoying to me.
I liked it.
I ain't watched Thundercats.
The voices were annoying. They all spoke like fucking heavy ass gods, except for that little animal.
I knew you was gonna be fucking anti.
Yeah, but that was the time. A lot of those cartoons,
right? Like all the time.
Now that is legitimate '80s cartoon.
Yeah, it's an '80s genre.
It's very '80s.
And that's why the '80s wasn't popping in cartoons.
It wasn't meant to be epic.
The '90s cartoons were at, bitch.
Nigga, they both was popping decades. I'm about to say, cartoons in the 80s were very.
It's
both
cartoons were popping.
Both
of them.
Both 80s and 90s. There were some great cartoons and TV.
Yeah, and music.
Yep, I give both decades some good shit.
Fuck y'all, crack era.
Earlier this year, that's in the 90s.
The 80s.
The crack era?
Epidemic.
That's the 90s.
I mean, technically, you're both right.
Yeah, late 80s. But you can't give it to
more like mid-80s.
You can't just give it to the 80s like the 90s ain't got a crack epidemic.
Right, like the fucking 90s was just totally clean.
Like crackless. the 90s were crackless.
Yeah, we weren't doing nothing in the 90s. We were just watching cartoons.
In 1990, we had no more crack.
The fuck out of here, man. You gotta play with your ass.
But y'all started that shit.
Earlier this year, it was announced that Michael Bay was directing a movie for Netflix titled Six Underground, which is set to star Ryan Reynolds and Dave Franco, among a few other big stars. However, a new report claims that title Six Underground is actually just a cover-up and that it's secretly a live-action Thundercats movie. The original premise for Six Underground said that the story revolved around six billionaires who faked their debts in order to team up and fight evil. The project was given a $150 million budget, one of the largest budgets to ever be given by Netflix, with the hopes that it would be spawned a franchise much like Bright. The script is being helmed by Rhett Reese and Paul Wernick, who previously wrote both Deadpool movies for Ryan Reynolds, hinting that the movie may be an action comedy. A reliable source connected to IGN has now claimed that this movie is secretly set to be about the Thundercats, and the entire Six Underground premise is just a ploy to order to make the Thundercats reveal a surprise. Well, y'all fucked it up. Mm-hmm. IGN has pointed out that their source is the same source that claimed that Simon Pegg would be in Star Wars, The Force Awakens, which ended up being true, and they're certainly reliable. Blah, 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 blah. Michael Bay may be the director. Some people are very angry that it's Michael Bay.
Yeah, because Michael Bay known to fuck some shit up. He's gotten to write a few things, but he's also known to fuck some shit up.
Yeah.
Also true.
Also true. Very true. I mean, like, after Bad Boys 1, he got suspect. Mm. Honestly. Because then it was, like, everybody knows him for explosions more than content.
I do like his explosion game, though.
His Transformers game was cool.
Transformers 1 was cool. Part 2 was racist.
M. Night Shyamalan fall on the same plane with me sometimes.
M. Night's gotten better, though. He's rectifying his wrongs. Yeah. We're going to see Michael Bay can. His dog, like, Split was the shit.
I didn't see it.
And this third film that's Underground, Split, and Glass. Glass is about to be amazing, it looks like. So Split, nigga, if you haven't seen Split, we can watch Split whenever you want to see Split. Because Split is an acting fucking showcase. Right. Oh my God.
Speaking of stuff that I can't wait to come out, when is Jordan Peele going to drop his next fucking horror?
The joint with Lupita?
Yeah, something.
He got something with Lupita he about to do.
Oh, okay.
So, you know, look out for that. I can't wait to have that pop off.
What's this Daredevil shit
pop? Daredevil just released his first teaser. And I've been watching IronFist Season 2, and I know we're going to review it on reviewing that, but it's not bad. Because I'm telling you, we ate IronFist Season 1 alive. Mm-hmm. I mean, alive. But, nah, son. That best Season 2 is like, Danny still ain't my favorite or whatnot. But it's much better. The fight scenes in particular. It's like they let us know, like, no, nigga.
Nigga's been putting him in the dojo.
Now, he still need to go work out or something. Because the tattoo on his chest still look like some bullshit. Right. But, yeah, big ups to them. Big ups to Iron Fist Season 2, man. And Daredevil just dropped a teaser for their Season 3. I just wanted to catch that right quick. But for whatever reason, it's not loading the fuck up. Also, Joe, you saw both parts of the Bobby Brown story?
I seen the first part and a little bit of the second part.
How you feel about it?
I tell you this. Okay, listen, guys. I'm going to get real personal with y'all on this podcast right now. These are a few things I feel about it. One, I got to come at the gay world for shaming Bobby Brown saying that he wouldn't have had sex with Janet Jackson. Janet Jackson would never have sex with him. That's a lie. Janet Jackson also married Jermaine Dupri. So how dare they say she couldn't fuck the king of R&B in his prerogative days?
I mean, I think we talked about this at the top of the podcast. Am I tripping? We didn't?
No.
Well, I'm going to say this. Like, I get mad at people for forgetting how big Bobby Brown was in the 80s and early 90s. Are you kidding me?
What?
Right. Like, yes. I'm not surprised at all that him and Janet Jackson had sex. And then y'all acting like that was he was clearly Janet Jackson's side nigga. It's not like he was the boyfriend. Mm-hmm. Like, it was clear that nigga knows. So I can clearly see big-ass Bobby Brown being Janet Jackson's side nigga.
They just don't want to give Bobby his props. You know what I'm saying?
He was
they
a
just
sex
don't
symbol.
Like Bobby. He's a fucking abusive cokehead. You know what I'm saying? That's all people want to fucking know about him. You know what I'm saying?
Talking about abusive cokehead, the beginning of the movie, the first 3 minutes, someone gets killed, and there's dope and coke automatically out of nowhere. And just like the first 3 minutes, so you're going to get that off the door. I also like that there's one scene where they remake where Bobby and Whitney had a real life TV show in real life at one time, and they do the scene where in the shop trying out glasses, and that's the epic scene that everybody.
That was a part up. Two.
Yeah, and that's when they was like.
Oh, so you saw some of part two, so yeah. You know, okay.
So it's like,
I thought you said you only saw the beginning of part two. That's not. At least half of part two is that when you get to that point of being Bobby Brown.
Bruh, because like that's when a lot of things you start, the kids start come about, and how she being raised, and the coke is getting heavy. But that scene right there, I just want to shout out in particular because they nailed it. They had that shit shot for shot.
Shout out to that actress that's playing Whitney. She nails Whitney.
I don't think so.
I think so. I love her performance of Whitney. I love this. She got the tics. I fuck with her performance of Whitney, man.
I have to watch it.
I when it comes to acting, something about her, it's not embodying Whitney for me. And Woody, though he looks good, I don't think he has enough chops to carry the movie. I got to see the full second half, because in the second half he gets a lot better. But in the first half,
dark.
First half just seemed more like...
The first half is fun, like, honestly. But the second half, and it's dark too, but it's more lively. The second half is when all the death happens.
That's when everybody got to die.
Oh my God, the second half was hard to watch, man.
Whitney and Bobby, Christy.
You feel me? But, there's certain times where I feel like your boy Woody nails Bobby perfectly, and the other times where I'm like, Bobby was more charismatic than you naturally.
Right, and I felt the same way when we watched the new edition when he was Bobby in that.
I liked him in that
with the group, but I feel what you're saying. Sometimes it was like, damn, you nailed it, and then sometimes...
You ain't swaggy.
Because it's almost like when you watch the Tupac movie, when you look at that Pac and you look at real Pac. When I look at Bobby, Woody Bobby, and I look at the real Bobby, when you look at the exact scenes... The real Bobby was just more naturally charismatic. It was what it was. But I think Woody did a hell of a job, especially in depicting him growing to older age. Yeah. Like, how he is in part one is not at all how he is in part two.
True.
I got to get that to straight up acting. He has some real emotional scenes in part two. That's what I'm saying. Like, I won't say that he don't have the chops, but he really showed and proved looking at it as a whole from part one to part two. But I will agree with you in saying that in certain degrees, Bobby is just Bobby. And sometimes, because that's like Will Smith and Ali, certain things that Will just couldn't get that was just so Ali. Yeah, yeah.
But there's something when you let Malcolm into you like Denzel did.
But that, come on, nigga. You always go to the best of the best and compare it to these people that's still coming up. Oh, Denzel Washington is Malcolm X is one of the classics.
Will you let Tina Turner
come
into
you? Oh my God, no, X is the best.
Will you let Ike Turner come into you?
This nigga's naming legendary performances. And this little boy is like in his mid-20s. Let this man be, dog. He's probably right. He probably too young to even be doing his damn role. You feel me? But he did what he did. And for a BET movie, nigga,
Right, which is definitely
come on, son. You got that, my nigga.
You do got that, my nigga.
You got that, Woody.
Let me take my hater meter.
Damn, nigga. Malcolm X, bitch. And like, what?
Turn my brother meter down, dog.
Because I did like a lot of your performances. And real talk, out of everything, the second half is you do step it up a whole natural.
He does. He does. Everyone does in that second half.
Honestly, I just wanted you to, I guess, smile more.
Me too. Because Bobby was and there's certain times when he's performing, Bobby was always having fun. Fine. You know, sometimes you could tell that he's trying to keep up with the dance steps, or he's trying to keep up with the words. When I'm like, son, show me more fun in some of these performances. Right. He does have fun at times, though. And I'd be like, yeah, give me more of that. And then it seemed like he get back in his head and he going back to the dance moves. It's like, ah, nigga, Bobby made that shit so effortless.
He's
like,
smooth with this shit, nigga.
But sometimes he gets it. It's so weird watching that. It's an interesting study, dog, because this is still a younger actor. I'm not saying he's some little boy, but he knew in the game. Like, it's not like he has his fucking resume behind him. Like, this is a big role that was given to him early in his career. So to be given something so major, biopic.
You got a lot of people like it.
And I like it. You hear me? But I can like we're actors, so we can get very technical and tell the shit apart if we wanted to. But for what it is, for what he did, for where he at, for his age, for everything in context, I ain't gonna hit on the black man. Like, you know what I mean? All right, black man, get your money, black man.
Yeah, that bad, bro.
Also, in the biopic, they say it goes damn near detail to detail from Whitney Houston's documentary that came out. You know, she had a movie documentary.
Yeah, it was on Netflix. Bobby was producer. We got kicked. They got into it. So he didn't even watch the documentary. Bobby was like, ah, fuck that.
But the facts that the fans have said have lined up.
It was a great documentary.
No, not that it's a great documentary. That Bobby Brown, when it comes to Whitney Houston, like, there was no lie being told on Bobby Brown's side as far as being biased to what, like, a Whitney Houston style would be. It said the documentary from Whitney Houston matched up with
a lot of shit that he had in his film about her.
Yeah.
And the thing is, majority, like, you can't fit everything even to those 4 hours. Like, they say if you really want to get the story, like, read his book.
No, you can't fit anything in those 4 hours.
Right. And that's another thing, too. Janet has never said a word about nothing. All this information about their secret situation.
Kind of now that says she said something.
I'm going to get to that. But, like, over these years, that book been out for, like, 2 years. 2 or 3 years now. And, when it came out in 2016, when 2018. So, it's 2 years. So, she ain't never say shit. Now, this movie dropped. And at first, she wasn't saying shit. But now, this story came out today of some sources from Janet Jackson's camp. Apparently say that it was exaggerated.
Bitch.
You're trying to save face.
And it's not even her. Sources.
Well, yeah, bitch. Sources. Mm.
That makes it even worse.
Freak.
Doesn't look good.
You hear me? Like,
I mean, nothing's bad about it.
But Janet, don't front. Janet, you just was on TV and didn't even know what Hot Cheetos was, nigga. You just was on the interview talking about that. So,
I thought that was very telling.
That was very rich.
It was rich as fuck.
That is some rich ass shit right there, dude. Like, that is scary.
What is that?
What? You don't know Hot Cheetos? Yo, what kind of snacks you be on? Like, you must got the most platinum snacks that we don't even dog.
Kev on stage said it real, dog. You saw his little skit on that shit?
Nah.
Oh, Kev on stage with it all day.
I love him, dog. He
was like, dog, that made me feel another type of broke.
Yeah, dog. I'm a whole nother kind of broke.
Oh, my God. Let me see if I can find that right quick. Dog.
Like, he said about that, dog. Like, she legit did not know what Hot Cheetos was, dog. Like,
it's like really
nobody on
so...
your staff ever had a fucking random bag. Like, you ain't never had a random bag of Cheetos on any movie set. Like,
Janet gotta watch.
Never seen it.
Janet gotta watch a movie to reminisce on her broke days. Right. She don't remember being broke.
She gotta watch herself in Good Times and see what broke is like.
Right.
Oh yeah.
That's when.
I remember that. Yeah. This episode of that's what broke is.
What's the movie? What's the movie? The American Dream. That's what she got to go watch. Anytime she could go back on her broke
that's
days.
That's crazy, dog.
But Kev on stage, dog, I think he summed up the whole... Why does everything have ads now? Fuck you and your ads.
I think he's going to be big, son.
I think so, too. I fuck with Kev on stage.
Kev is going to be big.
Send Miss Jackson if you're nasty. Don't even know what Hot Cheetos are.
Is Janet Jackson eat Hot Cheetos?
Hot Cheetos?
No.
I love Hot Cheetos.
I don't even know
what Hot Cheetos is like the thing.
You really don't know what Hot Cheetos are?
They're like Cheetos, but they have hot sauce on them.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Oh,
yes. The way she said hot Cheetos. It wasn't like she hadn't tried them. She hasn't seen them. She was like, oh, is that what those are? Is that what the pores are eating? Oh, no, I have to go to 7-Eleven. She can't go in gas stations and stuff. She's rich. She's been a little sheltered as of late. Maybe if Justin Timberlake wouldn't have thrown her under the bus after Nipplegate and never truly apologized, she would be able to go to 7-Eleven. But no, he didn't, did he? Huh? Huh? Get some 20/20 hindsight vision and go back in time and apologize. Justin, but that's neither here nor there or anywhere. What's important is that I feel broke. And I'm doing okay. I got $27 in my account. But the way she looked at them, like, oh, you guys probably eat ramen noodles, huh? Shake Shack. She has a chef. She don't have the chance to eat snacks, right? Poor people's snacks. She don't go to the grocer's freezer. Are you crazy? She's been rich longer than I've been alive. And I feel like I need to get my life together, okay? I just need to sell something, create a great idea, or whatever. Because this brokenness that just came over me, I don't like it. It doesn't sit right.
Hey, that's I think that sums up that.
Like, I just can't imagine, like, what is a snack for Jenna Jackson, dog?
Fresh papaya growing out of the regions.
Man.
Somewhere in the jungle. Shipped in personally.
Man, man. And the chick that played her in there was a dead ringer. They got a good look. They got a good actress to play her in the Bobby Brown movie. Like, she looked just like young Janet. She had the voice and everything. Like, I was like, okay. So here goes this Daredevil season 3 teaser, man. Let me see what y'all feel about it. Even I don't think you've watched any Daredevil, huh?
I watched some.
All right. Mm-hmm. Are you going to give us ads too for a fucking 30-second teaser?
Yep. Everybody got to be paid. Especially on these small sites.
The weather started changing to the fall, man. My nose get to sniffing with it.
And big ups to Michael B. Jordan as well. He's one of the people leading the cause for the diversity initiative in Hollywood.
I am.
And, I was reading up on that, and you know, I'm saying, like, I appreciate anybody in power with power to use their power for, like, you know, the little guy.
Netflix just brought somebody on for that purpose too, right?
They just put a black lady in as executive for their diversity. I'm glad more and more of these companies are realizing they need diversity and inclusion.
Because nigga, your ideas are older, man.
No one's believing in justice.
What you saying, son?
I said because your ideas are old and racism and outdated, man.
Let our country is old, racist and outdated.
But we're so new. All right.
No one's believed that justice could be found in a court of law. In the light of day. But I was fooling myself. Darkness only responds to darkness. And the truth is, I'd rather die as the devil than live as Matt Murdock.
Okay. Wait, that's it?
Alright,
You really meant
to leave.
Y'all really
sound like Batman.
Something
like
you really meant
teaser. Okay, that was a letdown.
That was a real teaser.
That let me down. I mean, it was interesting, and if you're up on the show, like, yeah, cool. But
if you've never seen it before, that's a fucked up thing for you to watch.
Right, you're like, what's going on? What's popping? What's wrong?
Who's Matt this? Murdock? What the fuck are you talking about?
Well, that was an anticlimactic into the freaking Bass Nerd Out moment. Whatever.
That was anticlimactic.
Do you want to watch Daredevil now? I'm more watching that teaser.
Oh, yeah. I mean, I'm definitely going to get caught up because I love the fight scenes in Daredevil.
The fight scenes in Daredevil are amazing. And I'll say that from both season 1 and season 2, both those fights, like, yeah, that's what made people come down like me and Marty on Iron Fist so hard, because those fight scenes in season 1 suck ass. Mm. Like, major ass. But, you know, Daredevil, they set a certain tone. They set a certain tone for this whole mature Marvel universe of taking things all gritty.
I like that.
Man, I love it. Like,
I like gritty. Like, take some, you know, normal family shit and make it fucking gritty. Because, you know, people still want to watch your art, but maybe they don't want the candy corn version.
And that's the thing, too. A lot of these things that made to Netflix already were taken to the gritty level in comic books, man. There was this shit called Marvel Knights, where they'll take Daredevil, Punisher. There's a few of these characters I remember reading in the Marvel Knights world. And Marvel Knights were specifically the mature content and taking these characters into mature lanes. Like, so that's that. When I watch these Netflix shows, that's what it reminds me of. Like, oh, okay, it's like Marvel Knights on TV. So that's what's up. So, yeah, that was Bass Nerd Out moment, man. Joe, what's popping in your sports corner world, man? We're going to end on your sports corner situation. I ain't got no questions.
Alright, hold on. Give me a second. Number one, we want to talk about the U.S. Semifinals for the tennis being all four black women.
Mm-hmm.
So that's what we're going to give a shout out to that.
And the finals is going to be what? It's going to be Serena and old girl. Forgot her name.
Right now, it's a battle between Serena and Osaka today.
Yeah. Us today. Yeah.
At 3 o'clock.
And she was talking about how, like, Serena was her hero and shit. Like, she she loves Serena so much. So that's some great shit to go up. And she's being so respectful. I was reading about that. She was being so respectful. She was like, they're asking us, so what you got to say against your next opponent? She's like, it's Serena
Williams, man.
Yeah.
What?
Good answer.
Great answer.
It's Serena. You already know what it is. I can't say anything.
You know everything. Everything in the book. You know what I'm saying?
I'm privileged to even be going against her.
Exactly.
You know? Exactly. That's what that is. I can respect that.
That's going on, number one. What's going on in football? Petty New Orleans. We got more views for the Atlanta game against the Eagles than the Atlanta fans.
Explain that.
We in New Orleans watched more football. Like, we watched more people in New Orleans watched
their game than they did. So they take another L for that.
Yeah.
And they also lost. They blew the lead. They had a little bit of lead in their first game and blew it again to the Eagles.
In typical Dirty Bird fashion.
So Matt Ryan, you trash.
Did we win our last game, did we?
Yeah, we did. We won against the Los Angeles Rams.
I thought we played the Chargers.
Oh, was it Chargers? Yeah, no, they both from Los Angeles now. So, Los Angeles Chargers, yeah.
Oh, it's not San Diego Chargers no more? No. It's Los Angeles Chargers?
Yeah, two teams now.
Wow. Mm-hmm. Why?
Because it's L.A. We run shit.
God damn.
This is Los Angeles. We are California.
We are, right?
I mean, the Bay got like two or three teams too as well.
Damn, Cali.
California got a lot of fucking teams. Yeah, they got football. But on top of that, what else is going on? There was something else I want to say up in sports.
You said something about politics.
Oh, yeah. Well, you touched it with the Nike ad, with the Kaepernick thing.
Oh, that's what you were talking about in the sports corner with Nike and NFL back then? Back in Kaepernick. Oh, you didn't say it so then.
I mean, I was like, all right, cool. We nailed it. Let's nail it now.
Oh, shit. Well, yeah, I'm got nothing else to say about Nike and Kaepernick. Honestly, we
pretty much covered that.
We ate that. Yeah, numbed it.
Only thing I can say to that is that Adidas and Puma tried to get them first and bathed them.
Have y'all, how about this? Well, it's kind of sports, but maybe kind of not. Y'all know New Balance is supposed to be the official shoe of white people now?
Yeah.
The funny part is this.
Is
somebody,
that true or no?
Somebody got me together because I shared that on Facebook, and apparently they started. This is old.
They always been.
They've been endorsing Trump for the past couple of years.
Ah,
just that story resurfaced after all this shit about Nike because all the people burning their Nikes up.
You know what? Now that you're saying, I think I do vaguely remember that story coming out somewhere.
But I'm saying the irony that story has resurfaced is only gonna make white people have somebody to go by now.
It was like, so hey y'all, we
not white,
Trump.
racist white people, not all white people, of course.
Racist jackasses, period.
Yeah, racist jackasses and coons. Racist coons, because they got the coons out there that's quick to be like, hey man, don't fuck that Nike because blah, 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 blah.
Some of you spoons, that's more for Spanish coons.
Oh man, we can't name them. They can name them. We gotta ask them what they call that. Cause I'd be wanting to know what's the Uncle Tom of every other culture. Cause I know we call him Uncle Tom, but I'm more than sure there's a.
I'm gonna say, listen. What's the spoon? Do you like it? You can have it.
But I'm gonna say they may already be a word for the traitor. In each one of these other cultures for when the motherfucker that wants to... Because I just found out recently that Asians call their Oreos Twinkies. I didn't know that.
I've heard that before.
They're Oreos.
How we call black people Oreos, if they're black with the white on the inside, they fucked up as situation.
Twinkies. I've heard that.
In Asian culture...
Yellow on the outside, white on the inside.
That's what I'm saying. So the fact that these things exist, but that's not in our culture to even know, they might have an Uncle Tom figure or a coon word already. I want to know what them bitches are, though.
Spanish people, I guess you can say they're brown people. So what's brown on the outside but white on the inside? They're oatmeal pies.
Oh, they already say that.
I don't know.
We need some more friends from all the races to get us together.
If there are any Latina or Latino American people that listen to this podcast, please write us into flywithbats@gmail.com and tell us what is the Spanish word for
Coon.
Coon.
Uncle Tom.
Uncle Tom or traitor or something like that.
And Asian. Yeah. If you're another ethnicity besides.
All on the board. All on the
board. Just send them all.
I'm sorry, white people, y'all don't count on this one. Sorry. But
yeah, all, got all y'all.
Yeah, I'm sorry. But all the minorities, like, you know, what do you call, like in black language, a coon is a black person that's basically supporting white supremacy. Yeah. And anything black, they go against it even though they're black. So, like, in y'all version, like, what is, you know what I mean, what's the Hispanic, or what's the Asian, or what's the Indian, or what's the Arab version of the motherfucker that's going against your own race for the white man? You hear me? Same for Uncle Tom. Uncle Tom, even though when you get into the true story, it's a whole bunch of layers to this shit. But the stereotypical version of when we call someone Uncle Tom is when they're kissing the white man ass and shitting on black people, basically. So who's y'all version of the motherfucker that who's your sellout to the white man historically that y'all, and they might not have none. It might just be a black thing. It might really just be a black thing. That but I'm curious to see if it is or not.
Yeah, man. It's just a black thing.
So we send our question today out to y'all.
Right.
For who, real. Who are y'all coons?
Who y'all coons be? But yeah, so we about to get out this bitch, man. Like, this is that acting guy, Martin Bats Bradford. You can find me on all your social media platforms at Mr. Bats. Spell it, Mr. Out, you ain't gonna find me. Also, like I said, man, check out our movies on Gumball Monster 504 on YouTube. Thank you for the support that has been coming there. Thank you for hitting us up, flywithbats@gmail.com. If you want to be part of the conversation, you did. We welcome all you new listeners. Stay with us, stick with us. We appreciate y'all, man. I'm out.
And hey, it's me, it's your boy D-Mac. Follow me on Instagram at FrenchBread.kid. And make sure you follow my funky fresh line of apparel at your dig 504. It's hot shit in the streets. And I will see you guys on Side B.
Posse wine, it's your boy AlphaJo, fresh out of the gumbo, still deep in the roux. And if you're out in the streets and you're looking for me, you can find me on Instagram at AlphaJo504. That's J-O without the E. And on Facebook, that's Joseph Alpha Man Pines. And for side A, we out this bitch.
Yeah, it is.
That's it.
I'ma keep a general just like the army. Most real niggas know most niggas phony. Your shadow got your back, huh? Just like your homie. That's why shady niggas will harm thee. Just ask Caesar. Brutus got him and caught him before his last breather. If that don't make you believers, then you'll learn. Honesty is a quality that will burn, but it's cool. And trust is a quality you will earn. You a fool if you think you learned all of the rules. Imitating imitation and they calling it cool. I know a little bit, but go ahead and call me a fool. While you sprinkle sugar on shit and you calling it food. See, I'm just trying to groove and you standing on the wall with your hands on your balls making crab claws move. Trying to balk at a dog, but I don't balk. I just fall back till you think you winning, but you lost in the beginning. Ayy. One goal, one thing, one move, and that shit don't change. It's hurt. Real niggas do real fucking things. Real niggas do. There's only one goal, one thing, one move, and that shit don't change. And it's hurt. Real niggas do real fucking things. Real niggas do real fucking things.
T.I. Z.Z. Oh.